afternoon. This afternoon, Jandre has been serenading me, and I want to see why. Why this go away bird is a long time. There are a couple of very big, very fat droplets of rain falling upon me, which is busy tossing up interesting ideas. There are cheetah at Cheetah Plains, and rich grey colour. Brent has just got back from Hoedspruit, and he tells me that it was pouring on the road here. So, do we go? Do we risk it? Do we not risk it? We can always go and shelter under the lodge. We don't have the roof on, but once I get there, then I can't go all the way back for the roof. Should we be brave? Chandra thinks we should be brave. Rebecca, how do you feel about these things? She's not listening to me. Brent is acting as a distraction in Final Control. And Rebecca, I was saying, do we feel brave about going to Cheetah Plains? Do we feel brave? Do we feel lucky? It does look very gloomy.
No!
The FC is voting no. And I always want to have an adventure, Rebecca. We need a John Williams scored theme tune. It's getting bad rain, but all of you know how incredibly accurate my weather predictions are. It's so good. I'm always the exact opposite of what actually happens. So there we go. So it's going to pour down and then cover all of my bases. I think we should do it. I think we should chance it. Yeah, it is Cheetah. Most other things. Then I must, Rebecca, or I shall live with the deep regret of not having gone there. This could come back to bite us. Now there's all the evidence of our decision making. You'll all have to cover up for us. It was a total accident. It was an unexpected cloudburst. Ask forgiveness, not permission, or something like that. We can always go and hide in Cheetah Plains and in the actual lodge if we need to. Rusty doesn't have one because it broke. So, really, not that bad of a decision. We've got rain covers. Chandra's got his skirt on already. We can withstand most things other than hail and tornadoes. Well, no, I think I can get away from a tornado. Lightning we have to go home for. I don't play around with lightning out here. Well, I'm going to continue this internal debate as to what we should do and where we should go. I'm still not 100% sure what I'm going to do. I think I'm going to be brave. Go to Cheetah Plains. You believe in me? Yeah. Go some cheetah. You know what's going to happen is the cheetah are going to be on the Kruger. In the Kruger somewhere. It's a cold, cloudy day. I'm going to get all the way there and they're going to be gone.
Or they're going to be hunting.
They're going to be hunting ostrich.
Hunting ostrich.
What will I do?
Mermaids in the pan.
What shall I decide? There's going to be no mermaids in the pan. Don't let Chandra fool you. There will be no mermaids. And while we debate and decide, we are going to send you over in just a few short seconds to the start of the actual live safari.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good afternoon, everyone. We're watching this beautiful elephant bull moving through the thicket away from us. Now he was out in front of us, but he seems a little bit camera shy. It's a wonderful cloudy afternoon. Looks like we might get some rain. And this is Safari Live.
Ready. One. You are live, you are live.
Hello everyone and welcome again to another episode of Safari Live on our Sunset Safari. My name is Byron and with me on camera this afternoon is Gert. He's making a return, which is great. It's great to have him back. And on the other vehicle we've got Jamie and Jandre with her this afternoon. And then out on bushwalk is Steph again with VM. And it is a wonderful, wonderful afternoon. Looks like we might get some rain. Oh, I don't want to forget the ladies in the final control, obviously. Rebecca and Jerry, they'll be the voices in my head this afternoon. And look at that cloud cover. It does look like a bit of rain. The temperature was still quite high. It was in the mid-30s, so about 34 to 36 degrees Celsius, which is around 90, 96 degrees dropping. Well, the temperature seems to be dropping with this cloud that we have got around at the moment. Now, that beautiful elephant bull did show itself briefly, but it's moved off through the thicket. But I would like to look for a leopard this afternoon, and I'll tell you why. This must have been about 2 o'clock, and we were sitting around camp, and VM actually heard some impala alarm calling, so him and I went to go and investigate, and we quickly jumped in a vehicle, drove out, and it looked like we managed to find Karula walking past, not far from the camp. So I'm heading towards the Gallagher waterhole, and perhaps we're lucky and she went to go and have a drink and maybe she's lying in that area. So that is going to be very exciting. Don't forget everyone, we are completely live. So what we are seeing, you are seeing with a slight delay, but exactly or almost exactly the same time back home. Don't forget you can send us your questions on Twitter at hashtag Safari Live. Otherwise email us with questions at wildearth.tv and we'll gladly answer questions and we love your comments. So I'm going to continue my search for Karula this afternoon. Hopefully we get lucky. While I do that, let's head over to Jamie so she can say good afternoon.
And a very good afternoon to all of you and welcome to the actual Sunset Safari. My name is Jamie and this afternoon, what time of the day is it? This afternoon I have Jandre on camera with me, the camera very carefully wrapped up in its rain cover to help to keep it dry. Now Byron's already touched upon the weather, and if you were watching the pre-show show you would know that I was doing some serious debating with myself, Jandre, and the weather as to whether or not we can go all the way to Cheetah Plains. Whether we should risk it. Ha ha ha. I think we should. I think we're going to. It's only the odd droplet. It's nothing major yet. I'm not entirely sure which direction this front is moving in. There are stories of predictions of 100 mils of rain in one go over the weekend, which could be very interesting. It's something that I've experienced many times in the bush, and essentially everything shuts down. You can't get out, the roads are blocked, the roads are shut. You can't get out, rooms have a tendency to flood. We've bought a whole load of sandbags in town today in order to fill them up. Ooh, Jandre, we're playing with fire here. You like fire? Well, we're playing with rain, but
I like swimming.
Okay, we might end up swimming. Possibly all the way to Mozambique if we wreck the equipment. Oh. Hello, Waterbuck. What do you think is going to happen with the weather? For our new viewers who are perhaps joining us for the first time, this is one slightly nervous waterbuck. And she's very nervous at the moment because the wind is howling. A particular waterhole, because the water levels are quite low, doesn't afford much in the way of a good view of the surroundings. So she doesn't really have any vegetation to cover herself, so she feels very, very vulnerable when she's standing at the water's edge. And that's why we can sit with waterbuck generally for as long as we like. They look at us placidly and blink. But that's why she got up and ran off when we arrived. So she's just feeling a little bit nervous on a day like today, and for good reason. As Byron said, Karula was moving about the area. Not that Karula would most likely take on a waterbuck that size, but the predators are moving. We've got to go. The longer we delay, the bigger the chance they're going to have moved. They might go into Mala Mala, they might go into Kruger, but it's worth the risk, isn't it?
Yep.
It is worth the risk. It's worth the risk. And the sky smells like rain. What a beautiful afternoon to be out. And on the bright side, the sky is much lighter that way than it is this. Whoa. Poor sandpiper looked as though it was being blown completely off course, out of control. It's a type of bird. I think it's just taken off and it's being gusted about. Okay. Let's do this. Enough indecision. Enough indecision. We're going to go. We're going to try out the great plains of the cheetah. And while we do that, Stiff is out on foot. Let's go and hear from him what he thinks the weather's going to do.
And good afternoon and welcome to the bushwalk of this afternoon's safari experience. And you are pretty much at the eye level that Karula was about an hour ago, only about an hour ago. For those of you just joining us, Karula is a female leopard, a very well-known female leopard to this area. She is a mature female leopard that has been holding over this territory for a number of years right now. And right here is her footprint. I'm going to circle it for you. The light is a bit flat at the moment, so it's going to make making out any distinguishing features a little bit difficult, but I'll try my best. Here we have the back of the pad there and the four toes. 1, 2, 3, 4 toes there. That is about as fresh as you can get a leopard track that's not attached to a leopard. This is the back foot, and then there you can see the one toe of the front foot with the back of the pad here. So she's stepping with her back foot slightly in front of her front foot, which means she was walking relatively fast in this particular sequence. And she then came where we're looking at right now, underneath this branch, and she went up and carried on to this drainage. So we're going to do for you on this afternoon's bushwalk. We're going to see if we can find her before the rain comes, at least anyway. We're going to try our best to do it. Bigfoot gives you a different perspective out here. It definitely gives you the vehicle-based safaris that we conduct over here. But it also gives you on, for one, what it looks like to be a leopard in the bush here at Juma Private Game Reserve. Alrighty, so what we're going to do is not really going to follow her footprints footprint for footprint. We're going to try and think where she's going to most look for her. So this drainage line pretty much circles up and goes past Gallagher Camp to the Mwati. Before we go on, I want to send you over to Jamie, who is going to be he's up to.
It sounds as though, potentially, Steph is going to be helping Byron track down and find Karula, which will be hugely helpful for Byron. And of course, Steph has Herbie as well to help locate the Queen of Juma. Sorry, my timing's just not quite right. I'm just going to slow down here, let the other vehicle get a little bit ahead of me. Otherwise, Jandre and myself are going to be eating up dust. It looks so positive and clear that side, and then when I turn and look behind me, there's just this deep, dark, ominous purple cloud. It's worth it though. We don't often get to see the cheetah, and I'm hoping that we will this afternoon, as I assume is this gentleman from Chitwa. Just bear with me one moment. I need to just switch over my game drive radio and make sure that it is functioning. So our game drive radios, there we go. Our game drive radios are a way of communicating between guides, essentially deciding who goes where, who does what, who looks at what. And it's a very good way of coordinating our searches and planning our days. Now let's stop for the moment because they seem to have spotted something. I wonder if they're looking for baby impala. I saw my first baby impala this morning on the sunrise safari. It was amazing. I think they've stopped. Let me just stop here so that we don't get in their way. We've got a whole herd of impala off to the left. I don't see any little ones, but they're sometimes quite hard to spot. So let's just hold on a moment and see whether or not we can see one. This morning's baby impala was absolutely adorable. It was jumping all over the place. It was stotting. The young males were interested in it. They were coming up to have a sniff, see what this was all about. This funny little tiny impala. Remember how the last time when we stopped and looked at an impala ewe, while she was alarm calling, we actually had a chance to see the baby kick, see the fetus kick inside of her. Absolutely mind-boggling. I do find it truly incredible that in the space of about 5.5-6 months, these antelope are capable of creating a little baby that is born ready to run, ready to jump. It takes it a couple of minutes to get onto its feet for the very first time. Equipped with the instincts, the knowledge when to run, to follow the herd, it's truly phenomenal. They are, as you can see, not too concerned, but looking off to across the road into Chitwa. I'm going to show you why it is they're looking across the road into Chitwa. Oh, goodness. Sorry, the rain covers make controlling things a little bit more tricky. There we go. I think they're looking at a herd of kudu. They are looking at a herd of kudu. Here we go. Another much taller and very elegant antelope that looks as though somebody dripped wet white paint down its back. Hello, girl. I love that quick movement with the tongue. I've noticed, particularly with kudu, they always do one nostril and then the next nostril. Just a quick clean. Now, unlike the impala, they don't have a strict breeding season, although we will see more and more pregnant impala over the coming months, because of course there is a peak in terms of the breeding season, or in terms of when they give birth. And it makes sense that that peak would fall at a time when their resources would be most abundant, which is now during our rainy season. Sorry, I also have to just listen to these comms. Ah, Trevor. Trevor would like to know who won the competition for the first baby impala. Chandra, would you like to tell Trevor who won the competition for the first baby impala? Safari Live. You did. The first baby impala was seen on the day that you said.
Oh.
Yes.
Have you seen that? Yes.
Yes.
Right, sorry.
No, it wasn't you who put them on camera. Oh, did no one get it right? Oh, it was the day between. Yes, yours was the Woodlands Kingfisher you won. Okay. Sorry. My apologies. Sorry, Trevor. It was in between 2 days. It was between Gendre and... Sorry, hold on a second. What is happening here? I know, I'm trying to... Oh, is he saying come? Cool. We might be in for a surprise, you know. I wonder what's happening here. Goodness. Yes, that was a surprise. I will say that was a... Hold on. This is not what I was expecting. Oh, it's a big Ellie bull. There we go. There. Oh, wow. Hello, gorgeous. Oh, I love these big Ellie bulls. Sorry, it's going to be a tricky one. Yes, that's going to be a little bit tricky, but I'm going to go back a little bit. Sorry. We're going to have to put up with this view for now. It is across our traverse area, so we can't go there. Look at this magnificent giant of an animal. I wonder if this is the same elephant that Brent had a couple of days ago. We saw two enormous ones. Oh, now there's lightning as well, Gendre. We saw two enormous elephant bulls not too long ago, and they are the true kings of the bush. Sorry, I'm in a pile up here. There's a vehicle coming behind me. Oh, how's it, Peter? How are you?
I can
did, thank you. Oh, that's stunning. Sorry? Yeah. Well, I think I'll go and have a look and see if I can find them.
Gala's still south of Dekkerbin,
eh? Oh, really?
Yeah.
The Nkumas haven't come back onto our side. We've just got one Birmingham. Yeah. I know, I'm starting to wonder. I'm gonna go all the way to Cheetah Plains and have to hide somewhere. Cheers. Sorry, everybody. Just chatting to one of the fellow guides and getting his feedback on what's happening. Isn't this magnificent elephant bull thoroughly good company, though? We don't often get to see the really big bulls. Now, they come in from Kruger, but they don't spend all that much time on our side. So when we do see these giants, it's an absolute treat. Hey, big boy. And they're such wonderful elephants because they are completely secure. They're completely secure in themselves and the fact that they are the biggest creatures in the bush. There's absolutely nothing out here that will harm a massive bull elephant in his prime. And they know it. And as a result, they're actually generally incredibly tolerant and very comfortable in the presence of vehicles and of people. They've got this amazing walk as well. Slow, gentle swagger. Stopping to feed. Look at that. He's moving the dead trees away with an incredible show of strength so that he can get to the grasses underneath it. Sorry, everybody, I can't reach the volume control. Just bear with me. There we go. That's better. Okay, I'm sorry. I think that we should go. I think we should go and come back. I'm starting to worry. I'm actually genuinely a little bit concerned about this weather. So we're going to start racing through to Cheetah Plains. This bull is absolutely lovely. And I would love to spend more time with him. But we're going to start running out of time here. So while we race off towards Cheetah Plains, let's go over to Byron for an update on his afternoon.
So I'm driving very, very slowly in this area at the moment where I think Karula is. I did see tracks of her. She did go straight towards Gallagher Waterhole. She had a little drink there and then moved on. It looked like she carried on further north, but there are a lot of thick drainage lines in this area and it's perfect for a leopard to hide. Now the thing is, this weather at the moment is not really in our favor. It's very, very windy. So we might not necessarily see too many other animals moving around, and you can see, look at all the trees at the moment in this wind. But it's actually ideal conditions for leopards to hunt. So leopards, because they're ambush predators, if they are moving through a thick area, with this wind blowing so much, it makes it difficult for the prey species, so any antelope species, to smell the leopard perhaps and probably hear them. And it will be favorable conditions for a leopard to hunt. Also in the rain, if it does start drizzling, often you'll find after rains, you might find some leopards that have got a kill. Wow, look at this beautiful waterbuck. Just off to our left. Oh, look at that. Nice big waterbuck bull. Actually a lovely pose just behind that log. He's probably keeping an eye out for any potential predators. Jackie J, you'd like to know if the waterbuck have a specific birthing season. So Jackie, I've seen youngsters, waterbuck youngsters, through most parts of the year. I don't think there's a specific season. I'm just going to double check for you quickly. I'm just double check myself and make sure I'm not incorrect. But wow, listen to that wind, everyone. Isn't that incredible? Very, very windy. a beautiful, beautiful bull. Yeah, so Jackie J, I'm right. I have seen waterbuck youngsters or calves throughout the year. But generally, it's in summer, so it would be any time in summer, just because the amount of food and water around is beneficial for the females when they are feeding the youngsters, and possibly helps when they have got youngsters to hide them in thickets when the bush is a bit thicker in the summer after the rainfall. But they can give birth throughout the year. They don't have a specific season, like the impala or the wildebeest. That's a beautiful male. The females don't have horns. And if he does turn around, you'll see that very prominent white ring around the rump. So very easy to identify the waterbuck. And they look very shaggy, don't they? They've got, looks like they've got thick coats, and they do. And they do rely on water a lot. I have read that the waterbuck, one of the few antelope that may suffer from dehydration if they don't get a lot of water, and you could actually just see lower down again, sorry, on the belly where you were. Look at that hair blowing in the wind, so you can tell it's very, very windy at the moment. And you can see more of that shaggy coat. So because they're so reliant on water, they're often around water holes, and one of the defense mechanisms of the waterbuck is they'll run straight into the water to get away from predators. And they do have quite an oily skin, and that helps to allow the water to run off and not soak into that thick coat and bog them down too much. I actually saw some images a few days ago. Somebody had photographed a few waterbuck all standing in a pan of water, in a little, not quite a mud wallow, in a pan. And there were wild dog that had been chasing them, and they was all standing around the edge of the water trying to get to the waterbuck, but they were standing safely in the water. And I have seen wild dog actually run straight through the water when they are chasing any antelopes. And little green teapot, you say it's fascinating how the antelope all have different horns, and it is, and it's a nice way to identify them because all the horns are slightly different. Some are very different compared to the others. If you think this waterbuck has these beautiful curved horns, which curve around, and if you think of a kudu, for example, that have those very long spiral horns. Look almost like corkscrews compared to these waterbucks. So yeah, it is very interesting to see the different horn shapes and sizes in the many different antelope species that we get around here. I can feel the temperatures dropping even more now with the wind picking up. I just, you know what, I don't know if it's going to rain. I'm just having a look. Maybe later tonight, but I don't know. There's some ominous clouds building, and you can smell the humidity or the moisture in the air. So I'm hoping it does rain, but we will see. We'll see. Let us continue our search for Karula, the elusive Karula. Trevor, you asked about the waterbuck when they are killed or when they die. Do they release a lot of that? I wonder if it's the oil that you're thinking of in the skin. To be honest, Trevor, I've heard and read many different theories on that. Some people, and the myth is, or there is a myth that people have come up with, and they say lions, for example, won't hunt waterbuck, or predators won't hunt waterbuck because they don't like the taste of the meat. That is an utter myth. That is not true at all. Lions, leopards, they'll definitely hunt waterbuck if they get the opportunity, and they will feed on them. The Nkuhuma pride killed a waterbuck not too long ago, I think a week or two ago. So apparently, the oil is quite strong, and you can sometimes smell a waterbuck if they run in front of you. They've got quite a pungent smell, but I don't think it's a case of them releasing it before they die. I think it's just in the skin in general, but predators still feed on them. Okay, so I'm going to carry on searching very carefully around this area. Steph is still on foot. Let's head to him and see what he's found and what he's up to.
Yeah, those waterbuck that Byron was talking about do actually have quite a pungent smell, and it's actually created the folklore that lions don't even like to eat waterbuck, and that their meat is distasteful and that we can't eat it. But it's actually just got to do with a bunch of glands in their skin, and as you strip away the skin, if you're careful not to let the oil that comes out of their skin onto the meat, you can actually eat it. Waterbuck tastes okay, and I've never seen lions complain too much about it. Talking about lions, we've got a lion of the spider world, actually more of a cheetah of the spider world actually. This is the nest of a grass spider. And inside this nest is a female grass spider. I'm going to try and tickle her out here. It's very windy at the moment, so excuse the shaky camera. There's the grass spider. These little nomadic spiders set up, there we go, quite camouflaged, but you can see her. These little grass spiders in the center of your screen, on the right, left-hand side center, that very camouflaged little piece of dust that's got eight legs, that's the spider. Now these are semi-nomadic. They set up their webs temporarily in bushes and branches and pieces of dung all over the place, and they run out and grab insects that come past at a speed that is unbelievable. They were for a long time considered the fastest spiders in the world in the Guinness Book of Records. Since then they have been eclipsed by other spiders and more advanced methods of measuring speed, but for a long time these spiders were considered the fastest spiders in the arachnid world. Just a little trivial piece of information there. I don't know too much else about these spiders other than that they have their egg sacs in the bottom of these little webs, and they like to eat termites. Oh, that's spectacular. I've fallen backwards and put my hand into that dung and urine patch of a female impala, and can smell from the urine that they're probably a couple of days away from giving birth. Yeah, don't know how, but a couple. Come on. Stop joking around and go and climb off of this hill. We are being blown to pieces here. It must be, and big ears like mine collect all the wind and make it virtually impossible for me to hear what's going on around over here. So excuse me, from time to time you'll see me touching my head over here just to press this earpiece that I have sort of to the center of my skull, right close to where my auditory nerve is. I can actually hear past the cacophony that my radar dishes tend to generate in wind like this. Let's see, this is a blown down knobthorn. And usually around this time of the year, you can actually find some interesting things in these guys. You just gotta be willing to sort of stick your head into these bushes and see what you can find. Now, believe it or not, this tree is actually still alive and will continue to grow. It is a combretum. The leadwood is a combretum, combretum imberbe. And we know from looking at all the variable bush willows out here and the russet bush willows that they actually do okay when they're knocked over. As long as there's one or two roots in the ground, they'll actually keep on growing and will eventually sort of right themselves. They'll have a couple of sticks that sort of turn to go upwards again and grow up back into the sky, leaving these side branches again in the shade and creating a refuge underneath them. Oh, here we go. I knew we'd eventually find something. Let me just make sure that these bugs are not going to... there we go. So then I catapulted it off into the distance. So they're hiding away from the wind inside there. I'll see what type of, looks like a beetle from where we're standing right now, but I'm going to show you how we know if it's a beetle or a bug. So a coleopterid or a hemipterid. So let's take it, catch it carefully. And what we're going to do is look at its mouth parts. And you can see that its mouth parts are definitely not made for piercing and sucking, which means that this is a beetle of some sort and not a bug. If it was a bug, it would have a mouth part that is distinctly shaped for piercing and sucking. And this is quite obviously mandibled. There we go. Let's put him back on his branch. Thank you very much for helping us with our insect physiology lesson there. And as you can see, back on the branch and quite comfortable. Except for his friend that I sent into outer space when the branch died. Right, why don't we go and see what Byron's up to?
And look what we've found, some zebra. Isn't this wonderful? And tails always swishing around on the zebra. There's a few of them here. There's at least five or six. Some have crossed the road and that we are on at the moment and headed off left. We can't see them at the moment, but at least we can see these two beautiful zebra right here. And if we're lucky, they may decide to walk in front of us and look at them enjoying the green grass that's around at the moment. I'm sure they are very, very thankful for all the rains that we've had. Turned the bush into this lush, or got this lush vegetation growing at the moment, which is wonderful. But as we say, we do need a lot more rain, so we're hoping, even with these clouds building, hoping to get some rain soon, more rain. A wonderful dazzle of zebra. That one looks quite plump. Look at that. And I wonder if that female isn't perhaps pregnant. I must admit, it does look like it to me. I think that female might be pregnant. Oh, it would be wonderful to see some zebra foals running around. Also don't necessarily have a breeding season, but in summer you do get a lot more young being born, and again because of the food and water availability. But also, zebra tend to have very plump bodies, and they are known as hindgut fermenters. So their digestive system is very different to antelope. They don't have the four-chambered stomach like ruminants do. Their hindgut fermenters are basically bulk feeders. So they feed on a lot of food, but what happens is the zebra actually build up a lot of gas inside their body, and it causes them to bloat quite a lot. So even though they look quite plump, and most of those bellies look very, very plump, it's purely because of the gases that build up inside their body. It's not usually a sign that they're big and healthy. It just means that they've been eating a little bit and the bodies have swollen. Usually the best way to tell if the zebra are healthy, if you look at that mane on their necks, if that's upright and flowing beautifully. Oh, we get them running across the road. There they go. Oh, wonderful. As they do that, just had some thunder above us. So as I was saying, with the manes on the back of their necks, if they're standing upright, and that's usually a good sign that those zebra are in good condition and healthy. Those looked healthy, and again, with all this green grass around at the moment, they seem very, very happy. Can you hear that thunder above us? Rolling thunder through the bush. That's lovely. I get very excited when I think it's going to rain, because I love the rain, especially out in the bush. And I remember working at a lodge when I worked permanently at a lodge, we would wait for the first rains of the summer. And, you know, everything's building up to it. You get these clouds building and the heat, and it starts. I mean, everybody gets very excited. And I remember one night we were sitting around and it started to rain and the heavens opened. And all of us were so happy and so excited. We just ended up standing and dancing in the rain, a whole bunch of us. It was great. And there's something about these summer rains in the bush that are just incredible. And it brings a bit of a relief almost, you know, and just settles all the dust, and you can just feel that new growth is going to happen soon, new energy. It's wonderful. So I still have had no sign or no further sign of Karula. I think she's hiding in one of those drainage lines not far from the Galago camp, to be honest. Oh, now, speaking of this ominous sounds of the thunder and these clouds and the scary rains, Steph has got something scary he'd like to show you.
Relax, dude. Relax, relax. Yes, so he can bend his head, eh? Mm-hmm. All right. So, talking about little beetles that we found on that tree, have a look at this monster of a beetle. This is a wood-boring beetle, and have a look at those mandibles. These beetles have probably the most robust mandibles of any of the beetles out here. And if I let him go for 1 second, he is going to bite me. So, I almost want to almost just show you quickly and then put him back on his tree stump. Just have a look at his eyes there, everybody. That dark horseshoe-shaped thing just behind the antennae there, that is his eye. These guys eat wood and bore through wood and live in these trees and live on what they can find. Just look at that. So this is a prime example of a beetle. They've got the most fantastic feet. Have a look at those claws. They catch on everything. I'm going to see if I can put him back where we found him, underneath here. So we found him there. Let's put him back. No harm done. He's probably as angry as a snake. Come find me later on tonight and, I don't know, scalp me or something. Cross these beetles. Come, let's go and have a look for some more fun things here. I must say, we've heard a little bit of thunder, and it would be interesting to see if you could get Byron to actually do his rain dance. I think it'll be quite something classic to see. we're looking forward to the rain out here, everybody. I must be honest with you. Look at this. We've got a tree that is festooned with drop tail ants. Now, these ants are quite gregarious, and they are also aphid farming ants. So these ants farm aphids, keeping ladybirds away from the aphids, and then they come and tickle the aphid, which appeases the ant with a drop of honeydew, which the ants then greedily sort of suck up. You can see why they're called drop tail ants, if I can find one. Can you see one, Vim? Is that their tail is dropped underneath their body and curled in underneath their body. The drop tail ant. You find them all over the place here. And they're pretty much all over this whole tree. Another rolling peal of thunder. Like I said, I think everything out here is just, apart from not wanting to get wet, I think everybody is just really wishing that this rain finally comes and we have a bit of a deluge. We're needing probably about, I don't know, before Christmas, probably another 200 millimeters of rain or so. Now, Jordan, you've asked me to show you some of the grasses that we have on the walk. Absolutely, Jordan. As soon as the grasses start to come out, I'll show you. I quite enjoy looking at grasses, and in particular, their inflorescences or their flowering parts. This particular grass is one of those real hardcore grasses that don't really have a smell. This is the Erigrostis gummiflua, or the gum grass. And when it is full grown and in its prime, have a look at this, Viam. Look here. We've just chased the praying mantis out of this grass. Have a look here. There. This is a grass living praying mantis. Right there. We've just chased him out of this patch of grass. And just have a look at the body structure on this guy. Very fast running. In actual fact, he looks like he's trying to imitate a tiger beetle. They've also got these fat abdomens. I think that's exactly what he's trying to do. Probably find he catches them. See if he'll be coaxed onto my finger. No, way too clever for that. Oh, there we go. Just look at that. Let me see if I can turn him slightly. So you can get a profile picture of him. There we go. Wow, I've never seen one of these before. I don't think he's a youngster. Youngsters tend to curl their abdomens up underneath them. I think this is full grown. I think we've chased him out of a hunting haunt here when we bent down to show the grass. Let's bring him up a little bit. Oh, no, no, he parachuted off of my finger and gone back to his grass stem inside there. There he is over there. There we go. Oh, just look at that. Fantastic work, Viam. I mean, even their eyeballs are camouflaged. Well, they have a collection of eyes, not really eyeballs. They've got like a multi-screen display, if I could put it to you that way. So because they couldn't fit all the muscle attachments needed for an enormous eyeball into one head, what insects do is they've developed a compound eye, or evolved a compound eye, which is many eyes across a wide sphere, all generating one picture. So you can have a very wide field of view. You obviously can't have lenses that can change shape, and so it gives you focused vision, but they, in their sphere, can pick out the most amazing detail and generate an incredibly wide sense of view. It's almost like putting on a 360-degree helmet, you know, those virtual reality sets that you get where you can look everywhere. That's pretty much what a praying mantis sees, and some flies and many insects, in actual fact. Quite interesting concept, eh? Right, it has started to rain a little bit where we are, so I think what we're going to do is make a sort of slow loop back to base camp and where we've got the tent set up for you. So we're just going to sort of get away from where we are now and move backwards towards the tent and see if we can join you from there. But there's still a few more moments that we have. Don't worry yourself about that too much. Let's see what we can find in here. It's one of those variable bush willows we were talking about, and a square-stemmed raisin. You never really find these trees getting very big. The elephants absolutely love them, and they move into these thickets and break the sticks off with great relish. And so it's rare to find a square-stemmed raisin with a diameter stick like this. This is about as big as what you find them here. Every now and again, find one a little bit bigger. Let me put my thumb there, give you some reference points. That's about as thick as you find the square-stemmed raisin. That's just an amazing, see, you can see the square stem there. All right, I'm gonna send you over to Byron and we'll probably catch up with you from the tent.
So, it appears as if this rain is approaching us now, getting a few drops. There's a beautiful herd of impala just ahead of us. Through there now, I'd like to see if there's perhaps a little lamb around. I must be honest, everyone, I think if it does rain, I do think that that we may have a few more births. And I mean, I don't know how much control these females have over the births. There is the myth that they are able to withhold the birth. But that's not true. That is not true at all. The impala lamb will come when it's ready to come. So I'm just going to have a look around and see if there are any impala lambs around. After the rains, they do tend to give birth. And I think because what happens is the rains mask the smell of the afterbirth and that. So it can help them. But again, it all depends. I mean, and these females are all ready to pop very, very soon, I think, ready to give birth. All right, I'm going to carry on to having a look around, but Jamie has got something exciting on Cheetah Play and she'd like to show you.
Have we lost comms again?
Let's have a look here. Oh no, there might be some comms issues again, unfortunately. I'm sorry everyone, and what does happen is obviously with some of this weather now, it doesn't make it any much easier. Let's just have a look. I'm still having a look at all these impalas around, but I see another antelope through the back. And you'll see it's a bit darker. It's a young male Inyala. And there it is, just moving off through the thicket, just behind the impala. Oh, looks like the rain is, and there's a male impala to the right with the young male Inyala. I'll try to say that five times fast. You might be able to hear some of the rain at the moment, a few drops hitting us. We have got our rain covers on. But hopefully we don't get wet. That would not be great. I mean, it'll be all right. We won't. Nothing will happen to us. We'll just get wet. I wonder if it's going to rain hard enough that we need to head back to the tent. That could be interesting. I haven't been in the tent yet, so it could be interesting. So no impala lambs, everyone. I've had a look, but there doesn't seem to be any lambs around at the moment. Let's head back to Jamie. Hopefully the comms are working now again.
And we have got the most amazing surprise for all of you. Oh. It's not the cheetah. It's not what we were expecting at all. And unfortunately, we're having to communicate. We're having radio problems, so we're having to communicate via mobile phone. But just look at the gorgeous new Styx cubs. Our very first sighting of them. And my rain cover just flew into my head. I'm sorry, that was the noise. But just look how gorgeous they are. Weren't they worth every acceleration, every bump? The fact that we are getting slightly drenched. Oh, babies, aren't you just too gorgeous for words? After all we've seen the Styx cubs go through, the last generation of Styx cubs, to see these two teddy bear little cubs looking so fat and healthy and happy. Hi, little ones. Welcome to the world. Just a few weeks old, they've only recently been introduced to the pride, apparently. To see them is a joy indeed, and I'm sure you're all incredibly excited to be seeing them. I know I am. It wasn't what I was expecting at all. It wasn't what we were rushing over here for, but what a treat this has been. Now, this particular female is a little bit skittish around vehicles, so we're going to keep our distance, and this will be the view that we have of them for now. But I think you'll all agree that this afternoon has taken a lovely turn, if a somewhat damp one. Now, we are going to only be able to spend a few minutes with them. There's only two vehicles allowed in the sighting, so we're going to have to pull out in the not-too-distant future to make room for other vehicles. And unfortunately, we are being quite thoroughly, excuse me, rained upon. I'm just going to pop my rain jacket on. Sorry, you're going to hear some rustling. I'm just trying to keep my microphone dry. Oh, gorgeous. I'm so thrilled. I'm so happy for the sticks. For those of you that perhaps have just joined our live safaris and you haven't met the sticks before, they very sadly lost their last litter of cubs to mange, to a serious, very serious mange infection. One of them was killed by a herd of elephants. The other seven, most of them it seems most likely that they were killed by the mange that they contracted. Oh, so lovely. This was worth it, wasn't it, Chandra? Tucking in to their milk breakfast, they're still far too young to even be thinking about meat. And it's hard to believe that our Nkuhuma cubs were once this size, isn't it? Sweet little teddy bear faces. Too gorgeous. I'm going to spend as long as we possibly can here before we have to leave. Just eke out this moment. Look there, that's what we were waiting for. Hello. Welcome to the world, little one. James Richard, on this Thanksgiving, you say, or for all of you that are celebrating Thanksgiving, this, you say that this is something to be thankful for, and what a privilege it is to see these cubs. Hi, look at you. Yes, you are gorgeous. Mouthful of milk, licking its lips. All of that healthy fur, and already licking and cleaning its sibling. A truly gorgeous, peaceful, intimate moment that we've got to share with the sticks on this gloomy, rainy afternoon. Kathy, you want to know how old they are? They're roughly, as far as I remember, they're sort of around 6 or so weeks. They might even be slightly younger than 6 weeks old. They're still very, very tiny. They are roughly the same age as the Nkuhuma cubs when they were first introduced to the rest of the pride. Mom's still keeping them relatively separate. She has apparently introduced them to the other females. There's two other females in the Styx pride. So she has apparently introduced them to the rest of the pride, but I think she might have done that slightly early just because there are no other older, boisterous cubs that could risk injuring them. Oh, little ones. Oh, how can you not? How can that not put a massive smile on your face? Okay. How are we doing for rain there, Jandre? Are we okay? We're fine. It's just the thunder that's worrying me. Is it your... it must be their first... it might even be their first thunderstorm. I'm trying to think if we've had... oh, look at the yoga. That's your leg. You're biting your toes now. Doing some thorough cleaning after a lunch. In between the toes. It's still so fluffy and so spotty. One big yawn from one tired mom. Well done, mom. Good girl. Your cubs are beautiful. All right. Okay. You think we're okay?
Just your monitor.
My monitor is, yeah. our yes, absolutely, to Charlie, you say, is there any chance that with the rain and the better nutritional conditions that they're going to help them be more resistant to mange? Yes, these cubs have a much, much better chance of being safe and sound from that mange infection. They might still get it, but this rain does wonders for reducing the possibility of it spreading. It reduces the seriousness of a mange infection. Their chances are just so much higher. These little cubs have been born at exactly the right time. And the rains have come at the right time. Time to save the new cubs of the Styx Pride and to save the Nkuhuma Pride. We couldn't be more happy that it is pouring down. Gorgeous. Okay, we have to run. We have to escape this weather. So we've had the briefest moment with the Styx cubs, but unfortunately we have to go. We have to start heading back towards Juma. But what a pleasure this has been, and worth every step of the adventure. I'm so glad we could share this with all of you. Right, on that note, from one little Styx cub, I think it's time to send you back over to Byron and the potential father.
So, no sign of a leopard yet, but another beautiful big cat. We have found one of the Birmingham males, and he's just lying out in the open under this marula tree. And he's also trying to get out of the rain, I think, perhaps. But these animals, they're used to the rain, or they do adapt to the raining conditions. They don't mind it. You can hear it's definitely raining a lot harder now. Isn't he beautiful? And if I'm not mistaken, I think this is Mfumo, the one with that had that nasty scar in the nose. And I can't believe how well it's healed. And you know, I actually mentioned it when I saw him 2-3 weeks ago, and that nasty scar was on his nose, and I said, you know, these animals, and these, especially these big cats, have amazing ability to heal very well. Look how well that scar has healed. You can barely see that it's still there, or that it was there. It's incredible. It really is absolutely amazing. And I've seen lionesses and leopards in the past get injured from perhaps hunting, and some serious cuts and scars, and you think, oh, I don't know if they're going to make it, but they heal very, very quickly and very, very well. As long as they try and keep cleaning the wound, it usually heals very, very quickly. So you can see it's really starting to rain quite a lot, and the wind is blowing, quite howling actually. I'm holding down our rain covers. it's fun though, it's fun. I was going to do my rain dance for you, but I can't now because there's a big male lion next to us. I'll have to save it for a rainy day. It's so wonderful to be able to sit with this big male, and we were so lucky yesterday evening when we had those two big male lions calling right next to the vehicle, so close to us. And I think this was one of them. I did see tracks of them heading, or at least one of them heading back in this direction from where they were last night. They headed north back towards Juma, into the central part of Juma. And I know this was the male that they found this morning. He was around the Juma Dam. But I wonder what happened to Karula and where she headed off to. Doesn't look like he's interested in moving anytime soon. Very, very comfortable there. All right, to everyone. This rain is getting a bit heavy now, so we're going to leave this beautiful mail line. What a lovely surprise. It was so great to find him and see him. We're going to probably start making our way back to camp. But there's somebody in the tent. Let's see what's happening there.
Yes, and we are coming to you from the tent over here, which is our sort of rain shelter. And I must be honest with you, it always gives you a bit of an exciting feel to be inside here. We've got the lights on, it's gloomy outside, the wind is starting to shake the building around a little bit. And of course, I can see on the screens over here exactly what you've been seeing. Isn't that exciting about all those sticks, cubs, and all this male lion that's potentially the father that Byron's got at the moment? We'll be up and running with some rain roofs in a second, and I'm sure we'll go back out there to join him today. But I just want to show you something. Come and have a look at exactly where we are and what we're doing right now. Viam has managed to find us a weather map. And what you're looking at is Africa. This is Africa here. There's Cape Town, all the way up, going up all the way to Maputo. That is in Mozambique. We are a little bit across from Maputo now. I would judge there, where those lines are converging at the end of my finger. That is where we are at the moment. And just have a look at where all this weather's coming from. It's all coming in from the ocean. This is Madagascar. And all these winds are pushing all this moisture in from the sea out over us. And you probably find it's carrying a lot of moisture from all the hot days over that sea. A lot of moisture would have been evaporated into the atmosphere, and now it's being carried in by these this wind and this high pressure system over here. And to where we're sitting, looking like it's fairly quiet here where we are. I mean, tough to say exactly what's going on, but isn't that just the most interesting weather map as you've seen, one of these dynamic ones that we've got going on over there. Now, the format for the tent is, generally speaking, that we sit and have a bit of a chat, and it also gives you a chance to ask me any questions that you may have in the covers or any discussions that you'd like to have. Of course, I can't show you much while it's busy pouring outside. I can't go and fetch anything and show you, and so I've literally got James's collection of things here, as macabre as what they look like. We've got this leopard skull and this dog skull above me. We've got a baboon. Here, you're looking at the baboon. That is a wild dog skull. That is a leopard skull. There we've got a bunch of other skulls. Serval, honey badger, jackal. I don't know what that last one, those last two are. I think the one's a genet and the other one is something as yet to, I have got to identify. But we'll be going through all of these at the moment. Don't forget, you can ask me a question using the hashtag Safari Live. And of course, you can send me a question via email at questions@wildearth.tv. And we'll try and get through as much as we can while the others are getting ready to do their thing. Why don't we have a look at what I've been playing with while I've been, not only have I been playing with the weather thing, I've also been playing with my favorite rock archer. Have a look. This is the microphone feed. And have a look there at those colors. Now, Trek, while we're busy having a look at this refracted light from water trapped in the crystal matrix of this piece of quartz, I'll answer your question about let's have a look at that, and then I'll answer your question about the weather. So you're looking at the light refracted from water that is trapped inside this piece of quartz. Now, this was not from rain. This was trapped in there when this little piece of rock was made or precipitated out into whatever fissure that it did in the granite base that is the rocks underlying Juma Private Game Reserve and this half of the Kruger National Park. And we're looking there at ancient water. Isn't it just amazing that rainbow of colors going from the one spectrum all the way into the other? Looks like it bends slightly. I mean, I can see from blue, I can imagine I'm seeing violet in there somewhere. I can see orange and yellow and red, green, almost all of the visible light spectrum I can see inside there. Amazing, eh? All right, so why don't I answer the question about the rainfall? Is it expected, this amount of rain? Have we had too little rain, too much rain so far? I would say that we've had pretty much an average year's rain so far. We had a week or two ago now, as far as I remember, we had about a week of rain. And in that time, we had about 25 to 35 millimeters. A month previously, we had about 25 millimeters of rain. A little bit before that, we have 5 or 10 millimeters of rain. And we're sitting at about average now for what we should get on an average year around here. We are expecting, as we go into November, towards the end of November, we're going to be getting higher rainfall and even higher rainfall into December, with our main rainfall months happening here between January and the end of March. That is when we get our highest amount of rain. The rain then sort of peters out in April. To the end of April, we'll see our last big rainstorm somewhere around the end of April. And then it's not uncommon for us to have rain in every single month of the year, but definitely it'll get colder with less rain as we go past May, June, July, August. In September, we may have a little bit of rain around Spring Day, which for us is on the 1st of September. Generally leading into hot, dry months, end of September into October, and our first large rains above 20 mils or so happening in October again, and then from there the gradual increase of rain throughout the year. So that's basically a pattern of our rain. We have a summer rainfall area where we are at the moment. We have normally about 400 to 600 millimeters of rain per year, and that is enough to support everything that you see around us. Everything that you see on a day-to-day basis is supported by just this much rain across this entire area. Isn't that incredible? This is lovely, really. All right. I just heard something over here. Now, grumpy old man, you've just asked me if on a bushwalk, if we had some rain falling in the area and there was lightning associated with the rain, would I be safe if I stood underneath a marula tree? Good question. There's no doubt in my mind that standing under a tree is a good way to get struck by lightning, especially if it's the tallest tree in the area. Marulas generally grow on crests of the hills out here, and they generally are the tallest things in the area. So I'm going to answer your question with a no. If the marula was on the crest of a hill, could you hide under any marula? I think you could. I think if you were next to a marula, say an odd marula that was growing on the banks of a drainage line in a dip, and it wasn't the tallest tree in that dip, I think you could get away with it. I think if it was the only tree there, I think you could. I mean, you want to stay away from earthed, tall, in particularly pointed objects during a lightning storm. I mean, it's one of the reasons why they build lightning conductors like they do, tall, earthed and pointed, and you want to try and stay away from those ones. Now, Milpro, you've asked me if we have lightning storms in our area. Most definitely. We have very violent lightning storms here. I don't know if it's a particularly high risk lightning area. I mean, I have seen, I'll try and pull up for you in a little bit when we've got some time, that sort of lightning map of South Africa. And we're definitely not the highest we're not in an area that has the highest amount of strikes per square kilometer. That's definitely the truth. But we are just off of that. And we have quite violent storms here during this time of the year. Do we find animals lying dead on the floor, trees split in half by huge lightning bolts? Not that I've seen. The odd tree that you see that has been struck by lightning from time to time. I've never in this area of South Africa seen animals struck dead by lightning. Not even a giraffe or an elephant or, you know, herds of animals that like to live on open areas. I haven't seen that at all. They tend to remain relatively unscathed, I suppose. One thing I would like to comment on is animals that are skinny like they are right now, animals that have got malnutrition or are very skinny and have very little fat reserves, a sudden chill like a storm brings to a place, lots of wind, lots of water, lots of rain, you do find animals dropping down dead just from the shock to their system. They don't have the fat reserves, they don't have the reserves to keep themselves warm. shivering only does so much, and it only can do so much with a little bit of muscle mass. And it's not uncommon in the first storms of the season to find, in particular, bush buck I found lying dead, water buck I found lying dead from this particular affliction. The state of the buffalo that we have at the moment is just another one of those animals that I would expect, if it was all of a sudden quite chilly, we'd find a few of them dead as well. Giraffe tend to remain unscathed. Now, Daniel, you've asked if this particular storm is a big storm. Yes, I suppose. We're going to see if we can show you a little bit out of the window there. That's what I can see from here. That is now where the storm is going to. That is the open patch. You can see the rain just dripping off of the covers. Let's see if we can take you out this side to the front of this particular storm and show you where it's coming from. I don't think it's particularly bad, to be quite honest with you. It's just there's where the storm was coming from. You might get a few drops on the lens as we're busy looking at it now, but there's where the storm was coming from. You can see there's no real color change to the sky. There's no big, thick, black, dark clouds. And in actual fact, the lightning has stopped now as well. And I predict that we're probably not going to see much more from this particular storm in the near future. Perhaps a little bit tonight when it gets darker and it gets cooler and the clouds drop a little bit, we might find a pickup of this particular storm. But I think we're going to need a little bit more moisture and we're going to need a little bit more heat. So let's hope that tomorrow morning is clear skies and it builds up and builds up again and gives us some decent rain. What can we expect from a rainstorm here in terms of amount of water falling? Generally here, our summer rainfall will give us between this much rain and about this much rain per, so about an inch to about 2 inches of rain per thunder shower. It's not uncommon though to have up to 100 millimeters of rain, which is about that much. And this amount of rain in this area is catastrophic. It makes everything run. I would fully expect the dams, Biffleshook Dam, Juma Dam, to be full if a storm had to break here at 100 mils. But on that note, Byron has his rain cover on and I'm sure he's dying to tell you where he's going and what he's up to.
So I've got the rain cover on, but doesn't seem to be working though just yet. It's wonderful to have a bit of rain, but this might affect our game viewing quite a bit. But we'll see, you never know, you never know. I'm heading back into that area that I think Karula is in. I just want to do a few loops around there and just see, maybe she comes out because of the weather that's changed. And who knows, we could possibly get lucky. Now I need to remember that there's a roof on, so I've got to watch what trees I drive under. But you can hear that wonderful sound of the rain on the roof. So Jeff, the challenges rain can cause on a drive, for one, it is a bit harder to find animals. Animals do look for a bit of shelter, so they'll move into thicker areas, so chances of seeing a lot of animals moving around are a lot slimmer. But saying that, you might still get lucky, you might still see animals moving around, but generally in my experience, it's not great conditions to drive around in for game viewing. I would say that's the only challenge, and then if you've got guests on the vehicle, they just get cold and wet, and it isn't very pleasant. But you know, we do have ponchos which we hand out to our guests, and that helps a little bit. But generally that would be the general consensus, that people decide to probably head back to the camp and wait for the rain to stop and then go out again late on a safari, or maybe just try in the morning. And that's one thing you need to remember about going on safari in summer, is the chances of it raining are a lot higher. But it does add to the experience, and it's not always a guarantee that it's going to rain, but the chances are obviously a lot higher in summer. I remember one year I was driving a group of guests, and we were quite far away from the lodge. We must have been about a good 25 minutes or so, half an hour, and we could see this cloud building behind us and the thunder and lightning approaching. We were actually viewing lions at the time. We thought, right, we need to start making our way back to camp, because also lightning can be a potential threat and can be dangerous. Usually if there is lightning around, we'll decide to call it quits far sooner than if it's just rain, because we don't want to put anybody in any danger. And lightning can be potentially dangerous out here. And anyway, so we headed back towards the camp, and while we were driving, the heavens opened and it bucketed down. This is a light drizzle compared to what we had. And we got soaked. Everybody was trying to hide under the ponchos, because the other thing is you can't see anything while you're driving, because you've got rain hitting your face. So you really can't see anything. And everyone was crouched under their ponchos, and I was trying to drive and navigate through the bush on our way back to camp. Needless to say, we got absolutely soaked. But it was an experience, and it was a fun experience. Just okay. Now I'm in this area where these drainage lines are, this thicker area that I think Karula has moved into. But again, I don't know, because it's straight through here and continued out and off hunting. So I'm not sure. I'm not sure where she could be. The other thing is, and Jeff, getting back to your question, the other thing is, with it raining, it will wash away fresh tracks. But tomorrow morning, with us being out on game drive, if we do see tracks in the sand, clear tracks, then we know they're obviously a lot fresher. So it does help us gauge how fresh tracks are after a bit of rain. But at the moment, it'll start washing those tracks away. So it may be a bit more difficult to see any tracks. Also, you don't have much bird life around at the moment. The birds all be hiding in the trees. Bree, you want to know what you can expect to see while it is raining. So you can expect to see some water dripping from the sides of the canvas and rolling down and splashing in front of us. Bree, it's difficult to say. And like I said, in the past and in my experience, the game viewing does become a bit tricky in rain or wet conditions. But the animals are still moving around. I'm just having a good look around this area to see if we can find Karula. If not, I'm going to head back to where I saw that Birmingham male and just see if that male has moved at all. You never know, you could possibly see some frogs starting to jump around and move around in the rain, possibly start calling. A lot of those little animals will start becoming quite active in the rain. And I think Karula gave us the slip this afternoon. And it was so nice to drive not far out of camp. We just had a little loop around quickly. We heard all the Impala alarm calling, but that was about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And VM and I quickly drove out, and we had a look, and we found her, and we watched her, followed her moving through the drainage line, and then she disappeared. So I thought maybe we're lucky and she'll go and lay close to the pan, that Galago pan. Well, she definitely went and drank there, but then she moved off. So I'm not sure where she headed off to. These drops are aimed perfectly in my direction. Sometimes the ponchos, they work in a way that they do kind of keep the rain out, but also once they let the rain in, they don't let it out. Okay, so I'm going to head back towards that area where we saw that Birmingham male, see if he's still lying out in the open. Let's head back to Steph in the tent.
I'm sure that that lion will still be there. I don't think those lions have anywhere else much to go, to be quite honest. Now, while you were away with Byron looking at the rain cover and driving down the road, James Richard asked if we could have a look at James's insect collection. And James, you're welcome to have a look at the insect collection. Let me go and see if I can stand over here. I'm just going to be pointing out some weird things to you. So we'll start top left and we'll work our way from left to right and then down. This is one of the biggest dragonflies that we get here. It is, in actual fact, the only two dragonflies, the tiger dragonfly and the blue emperor dragonfly that we get here. That is as large as they get. And for some scale, let me put my finger there so you can see it's about as long as your finger is. That's the largest dragonfly species that we find here. These interesting contraptions are bagworms. And the male and female bagworm, when they hatch, they start spinning a very strong silk, and then they stick bits and pieces of stick to it. And the female will live inside this bag her whole life. Eventually she will pupate and come out as a bagworm moth. The male, however, he comes out and he drags around his home looking for the females. Here we have some cicadas. That is a cicada. That's the largest cicada that we find here as well. And some other bugs. These are shield bugs. Them, we call them stink bugs as well, because when you touch them, they can secrete a very stinky fluid. It gets all over your hands and doesn't smell too nice. This is an assassin bug. That one there, they have a big proboscis that can stick out the bottom, that sticks out the bottom of their heads. Excuse me, that's just a bit wayward, my pointer. Sticks out the bottom of their heads and injects a toxin that paralyzes and dissolves the tissues of the prey that it has. So nasty little guy that can give a nasty bite as well. Let's go down here to the beetle. This is the beetle similar to the one I found on the walk this afternoon. This is the wood borer beetle. Big, strong beetle. On the left-hand side of it is the regal fruit chafer with its brilliant iridescent colors and those wonderfully hooked, clawed front feet that it grapples onto fruit with, holds onto the fruit and onto flowers, and then feeds on them. Here we have the largest dung beetle in this particular area. This is the flattened giant dung beetle. Beautiful dung beetle. Here we have one of the cantharidin beetles, or the ground beetles, able to exude a burning toxin that comes out of the joints in their feet called cantharidin. And some of them in the back end of their bodies, in the back of their abdomens, have two chambers which they can mix two chemicals together and spray out scalding hot steam and toxins into the face of a would-be predator. Here we have a fruit chafer, one of my most favorite of the beetles. The fruit chafers, they are two examples of two brilliantly different fruit chafers. That is the rose fruit chafer, and this one, I'm not too sure what it is. Let's go down a little bit to some more dung beetles. This is a dung beetle that I only saw active this year. These dung beetles live in lion feces. They like lion feces, and so this year I figured that out by catching one quite close to a lion dropping, and didn't realize what I was doing until I held it, and my fingers were the most unbelievably smelly things I've had on a walk in a long time. Let's go across here and up a little bit. Here we have another very favorite group of beetles that I love. These are the jewel beetles, the Buprestids. There's one, two examples of them. These beetles are the Tuktuki beetles, or the Tenebryonid beetles, and they get their name from the fact that they communicate with each other by bouncing this back part of their bodies on the ground, and they can communicate over quite substantial distances with one another. Males on males and males to females. They bash their bottoms on the floor. Coming down and left, I haven't really stuck to my let's start at the left and move over right, have I? Sorry, Viam. There we have the king cricket,
or the corn crickets, very large cricket, nocturnal cricket. And these crickets follow around the birds called quillias, red-billed quillias, can live in flocks here, a couple of million strong. And these crickets are quite common around them, where they feed on the droppings of the birds and also on the young birds themselves. How terrible a death would that be, being eaten by something that looks like it comes out of a science fiction movie? All right. Why don't we go and have a look at a dung beetle clip that we've prepared for you so that you can see what a dung beetle looks like, I suppose, in action. Let me go and do that for you. Go see what this looks like. Excuse us. Just have a look at that. Pat, pat, patting the dung into a ball. I don't think there's enough dung here to actually make a ball big enough for this one's satisfaction, hence this sort of frenzy. Let's see if I put his original ball close to him, if he'll utilize it. There he goes. Let's see, there we go. Now, Laura, they haven't. You've asked me how do they get the dung or the egg inside the ball if they've already rolled it. Laura, they've got an ovipositor, although it's quite small, and I'm under the impression that they don't necessarily lay their egg in the center of the dung ball. I've got a feeling they lay it just on the outside of the dung ball, and when it hatches, the larvae digs to the middle of the dung ball and starts to eat the dung out from the center. So it's not necessarily that the egg is in the center. I think the egg is just on the outside, or maybe just below the surface of the dung. The larvae then crawls into the middle of the dung and starts to feed. Now that's quite interesting. I gave this dung beetle the original dung ball that he was working on. I gave him that one, and he's now almost totally incorporated that dung ball into this one. Isn't that incredible?
Wasn't that the most awesome clip that you've seen? That was such an exciting sighting, I must be honest with you. How many of you saw when that dung beetle was patting the dung into the ball, how many of you saw a tiny little dung beetle, many dozens of sizes, smaller than that plum-colored dung beetle, living inside the ball and making sure that they got inside the ball? Those tiny little dung beetles with the yellow elytra, the yellow wing covers, are called cleptocoprids. They actually utilize the work of the bigger dung beetle, and without rolling their own balls, they just live inside the bigger dung beetle's ball and get rolled to a place where they get buried, and they have their own eggs laid in other dung beetles' work. Isn't that incredible? That was a very, very nice clip. I must be honest with you, I quite enjoyed watching that. Well, Byron has eventually got back to that male lion, and before he gets drowned out, why don't you go and see what he's up to.
So we're sitting with this beautiful male again. He's moved slightly, and he is out in the open. He got up and he just shook his mane, and all the water kind of shook off of him. And look at that beautiful view of him now. Lovely, lovely pose. Thank goodness he is here, because otherwise I don't think we'd be seeing very much. I haven't seen any movement or heard anything else around. The wind is still blowing quite a bit. And this rain, which is wonderful. It's good to have this rain. Looks like this rain is settling in. Look at that mane blowing in the wind. I wonder what happened to the brother last night. And this also happens quite regularly. These males meet up for a day or two, they patrol an area, and then they'll split up, and then one male will go in one direction, another male in another direction, and see if there aren't any females around that they may potentially meet up with. And perhaps this male was looking for the Nkuhuma pride, but it doesn't look like he found them. It's bit chilly at the moment, the wind blowing and the water. But that's part of being in the bush and part of a safari. See, no birds calling at the moment at all. They all seem to be looking for shelter. And Teo, you're a new viewer. Welcome. It's great to have you on Safari Live. And you want to know, why is a lion in the open? Well, you know, these animals, a wild animal, it will lie where it wants to lie. And I think, you know, they do adapt to the particular weather that you are having. And they need to, I mean, they get used to rain coming and going. And it's just one of those things. Some of the other animals will look for a bit of shelter. But is there really a lot of shelter around it? Even where he was lying earlier, he was lying under the tree. He was still going to get wet there. So he's just moved a little bit, but he's not too happy about this rain. It doesn't look like it. Lying down, not moving too much. And Pete, you want to know if the rain affects a lion's sense of smell? Yeah, definitely, Pete. I'm sure it does. Because what will happen is the rain will mask a lot of the scent of animals in the area and potentially just make it a lot harder for the lion to smell or pick up on the scent of anything. And what it also does, if animals and like lions have scent marked in a certain area, after hard rains, that scent will dilute quite a bit and it won't be as strong. And a lot of the times after rains, these animals may move around and start scent marking a lot more again, just to maintain it or maintain the boundaries of their territory so that other animals know where they are and which area they are moving through. So Elizabeth, these four males that form the coalition, the Birmingham males, they do meet up occasionally. But what happens, and I've seen it in the past with other coalitions, I've seen males or coalitions of five lions moving through in an area together. Sorry, I just want to turn something down quickly. And those lions, what happened is, especially when they get a bit older, so we had five lions in a coalition, and as they became a bit older, their territory was very large and they patrolled the whole territory. They would meet up occasionally, but then what would happen is you'd have two split off and then three split off, and they basically patrolled different parts of their territory and they stay within those areas. And I think that's kind of happened with these Birmingham males at the moment. Even though they do meet up occasionally, it sounds like, and from what I've seen being here, two males are dominant and really seen a lot around this area where we are, and the other two males seem to be a little bit further east. But that's not to say they won't meet up again. They will definitely meet up, and they do know that they're part of the same coalition and they are related. And what happens is it just helps them keep a broader outlook on their territory and keep out any potential threat or other predators moving in and trying to take over their territory. So they will definitely meet up, but then, and again, you might find three of them together and then one off on his own, or you find all four together, or you find two together, one on his own and another one in another area. It all varies. It varies constantly. As long as they're in their territory, they'll feel safe. And if they need each other, they will call and contact one another, and that will know exactly where they are, and they'll meet up again. So just like last night, we had these two together. The other brother was with him, and they were calling, roaring, probably trying to find where the other lions are, and the other brother most likely headed into the area where he thought they were, and this one headed back this direction to try and meet up with the females perhaps. We don't really know, but it does, those movements vary a lot. It's nice to sit with this male even though it is raining. Michael, you wanted to know if the lions have oils in their fur to help protect them from the rain. I don't know, Michael. I'm not sure. I've not been close enough to a lion to check. but I would assume that they have got some form of oily substance to kind of help the rain drip off a little bit. But when lions get wet, they get wet. It's Not like that waterbuck that we saw earlier that probably won't get as wet. You can see the rain dripping off his nose over there a little bit. Oh, that's a lovely view of him. Isn't that wonderful? But no, they'll definitely still get wet. And this the sound of the rain on the roof, and that it's very relaxing and it's soothing. And I really do love the rain and the sound on the roof, mainly when I'm in bed and warm and listening to it. But this is still very pleasant and very peaceful. Just scanning around to see if I don't see any other animals moving about. But nothing at the moment. Liz, interesting comment. You wanted to know if these animals occasionally sit in the rain to try and clean themselves, and it would be a possibility. You know, lions are cats that groom themselves regularly, so they do try to stay clean, and I wouldn't be surprised if sitting in the rain has got to do with some of that, you know, trying to keep the fur clean a little bit of a wash. I don't know if it's a conscious thought or if it's just, well, it's raining, might as well sit it out and wait for it to stop. So I'm not too sure if it's worth leaving this line to look for anything else, because I don't think we're going to find too much, to be honest. I'm just scanning around at the moment. There's not much movement and listening. But I'm going to sit here a little bit longer and just see what happens. While I sit here, Steph managed to get a visitor in the tent.
Jamie has finally managed to join us, looking like she's just swum here all the way from Cheetah Plains.
That was pretty much it. The rain was stinging.
We are going to try and get her into drier clothes as soon as we can. Don't worry, Jamie, we'll look after you.
Thanks, Steph. Look, my fingers have got all
white
and wrinkly and pruny.
So what that means is that the skin, which is sort of semi-porous, has absorbed a lot of water. The white is dying now in her. Remedies to her core to stay warm. We'll get her sorted out.
I've asked Brent to bring me some clothes, and Herbie's fetching me Steph's jacket. So it is, I will be warm at some point in the not too distant future.
Something quite special to show you right now. Obviously today we've had next to the looking this afternoon into our little English. We've prepared two, but I must warn, got a little bit.
Oh no, now even the tent is having some signal issues. Jamie, what are you doing in the tent? I'm just trying to put down another cover just to kind of protect us a little bit more from the rain. So we actually, we're fairly cozy for the moment. A little bit wet, but that's okay. And now, but the wind is blowing, which is not ideal. The joys of a rainy safari. But again, as I said, part of the experience. And at least we can still show you some lions and chat about the lions. Or the lion. It's actually, I mean, that's such a wonderful pose. It just looks like this lion is scanning over his territory and his, I mean, I don't know if you could say his kingdom. You know, often the male lions are referred to the king of the jungle, and it looks like he's just scanning across the Juma Dam, having a look for any signs of, I don't know, anything that might be moving past. But it's a wonderful, wonderful spot that he's found there. And Paul, you say this male lion really looks like the king of Juma. He does, doesn't he? Looks like he's been working on his hairstyle a little bit too. I wonder if that little bit of wind that we've got at the moment is helping him. Kind of a slick back hairstyle. And just listen to that rain, everybody. What a wonderful sound. SH, the rain is definitely good for lions when they are hunting. And I was chatting about it earlier. And, sorry, I'm just going to hold this canvas cover down. So it definitely does help. And I've seen in the past, animals, these predators do enjoy hunting in weather like this, because what happens is it masks their smell, their sound. The other predator, the other animals probably won't be able to hear them or smell them. So it provides a good platform for them to start hunting and start looking for prey. And if they're moving through the bush, it does make it a bit easier to potentially stalk and try and hunt. So yes, in weather like this, it does help. It definitely does help. Not just lions, but also leopards. I think the only animal that wouldn't really, or that I've seen, I don't think would really hunt, would probably be cheetah in the rain. I'm not sure. I haven't really seen it. Maybe up in East Africa and that. But I do know that lions and leopards do enjoy hunting in the rain. Sorry, just trying to stabilize this little rain cover we got here. That might help a bit. There we go. So we're going to be closing ourselves in here soon. You might not see us at all. And again, we're so thankful for the rain, because it is so crucial that we do have this rain. And it is always, always very, very welcome. And I expect and predict a lot more rain this weekend. So let's see, it could be very, very interesting. David, that's an interesting question. And with this overcast weather and this raining weather, David wants to know if maybe some of the nocturnal animals could get confused and come out. I don't know, David. I don't know. I don't think so. You know, it is still pretty light. So I don't think they still know that it's daytime. I don't think the overcast weather affects it that much that they think it's dark. So I don't think so. I think if anything, this rain might keep some of the nocturnal animals hunkered down a little bit longer, and they won't necessarily move around as much during the night. That's one theory, but I don't think it would cause them to come out any earlier or cause any confusion. Oh, there's a bit of a yawn. Let's see if he gives us another one. Now we know, you know, it's always a guess really, but generally the yawning, these lions and big cats do it a lot. When they are waking up, they're trying to get more oxygen into the body. So trying to wake up and potentially move around. It could just mean that they're going to get up, move, change positions and lie down again. But a yawn is often a good sign that they might start getting a bit active and moving around. But let's see, I'm curious if he yawns again. Sounds like he thought he heard something there. But he's still just sitting out in the rain. All right, well, I think we're still going to sit here a little while longer. Let's head back to Jamie and Steph in the tent.
We have got Jamie warm and snuggled up in
this. This is so cozy right now.
The biggest jacket
that
we could find.
and Herbie, thank you to Herbie for fetching it as well.
Herbie fetching it as well. All right, we've got something exciting to show you. We prepare a series of clips just in the eventuality of rain like this. And one of them that we have to show you is a tribute to Karula, basically because she was around our camp this afternoon. And we haven't seen her for a little bit. I can't remember the last time I've actually seen Karula. I haven't seen Karula. In actual fact, I'm going to make a statement here. I haven't seen Karula's cubs since they were born. So I haven't.
Really?
And I haven't.
Not even when they were.
No,
here.
They tend to run away from you when you...
You were in Hoedspruit that weekend.
Yeah, it's bad. Anyway, I need
we'll
to get
to
up and see.
Remedy that.
All right. Now, it is about the sighting where Karula caught a little baby Nyala and then gave it to Hosanna to finish off. So it is going to be a little bit graphic. And so for those of you with sensitive constitutions, what I'd suggest is that you blink rapidly, turn a head away, go fetch a cool drink from the fridge, perhaps. We're just going to be showing it to you. And then Jamie and I are going to discuss it as well, so you can join us back when we're there. Anyway, enjoy the clip. We'll see you after.
For those of you that are sensitive viewers, please turn away from your screens now. I'll tell you when it is safe for you to watch. Karula's just now pounced on a baby Nyala that she's managed to catch. She snuck up on it. It's still alive. It is still fighting and still kicking. But unfortunately, the poor little thing really doesn't stand a chance. Now look at this. Look at the behavior of the cubs. It's coming in to try and help. Look, it's hissing at Mom. It wants to try and help. Karula knows. There we go, look at that. And she's left it. And this is how young leopard cubs learn. A very difficult sight for us to watch, especially where a little baby antelope is concerned. But it just goes to show the incredible power of Karula and how skilled she is as a huntress. Oh, what an incredible series of events, from Karula catching the Nyala to the movement of Hosanna moving in and hissing at her, and the fact that she did just leave the Nyala to him. So she knows that this is something that he has to learn. And listen to this. The standoff is over. She knew there was something, but she didn't realize what it was. And now she's barking out her alarm call. Off goes Mom. She's given up. And survival instinct has won.
Wasn't that just some absolutely amazing footage that we saw there? Something that is a need out here. Mothers, especially mother leopards, need to teach their youngsters how to catch and kill. It's not something that, I think the catching the kill, catching the animal is instinctive, but how to kill it and how to kill it quickly is obviously something that is learnt through much experience, and it starts from quite a young age. But you were there, Jamie, like, how do you, I mean,
it happened so fast, and what was amazing about that sighting was Hosanna hissing at her before he got onto the kill itself, and she kind of just went, well, fine then, it's all yours, you take it, you sort it out. And luckily, very fortunately, it was actually quite a quick death. I was sitting watching, expecting quite a prolonged, because he clearly didn't know what to do, and he was grabbing for the neck and he was grabbing around, and he just didn't quite know how to go about it, and then he jumped and he moved and it was over. was very quick, which was a relief.
Do you think that there was some of Hosanna's character coming out in that little interaction with his mother? You know, it's so rare that I've seen two leopard of that size with a mom interacting over a kill. You see them on kills quite often, but you don't see them interacting like that. Do you think it was a little bit of his character coming out?
I think it was very interesting to watch, because at the end of that all, he didn't eat any of it. He hardly ate a thing. He chewed a little bit on the head and then gave up. His sister came in, hissed at him, and he went, okay, it's yours then. And he gave it to her. So it was an interesting, they had eaten the day before, so they weren't hungry.
Yeah.
But I mean, he's sort of building up a reputation as quite the clumsy character, which I think all young leopards do, they go through that phase. But his sister somehow seems to problem solve a little bit better than him. I've watched him with an impala dangling over a marula tree, and it's sort of hanging by a strip of skin. And he can't quite get it, and he ends up tying himself in knots, and he doesn't know what to do. Whereas Shungile will go and she'll look. She grabbed it and she just pulled with her. She pulled back with her triceps and then started feeding with her head hanging off the tree.
Well, they say that ladies develop a little bit quicker than the boys do, so you know, maybe we're seeing a little bit of immaturity coming through over there. But what is quite interesting is, subsequent to that kill sequence that we've just seen now, we have seen him display quite extrovert behavior, where he's gone off a distance from where his sister is and left her, and she's a little bit shyer around I would suppose any utterances in the bush, noises in the bush. She immediately, I can see her ears go flat. I have seen before, watching the feeds from you, and go down into quite a defensive, maybe even a seclusive posture. Whereas he seems to be, you know,
she's very alert. She's very alert and she's very aware. And Hosanna is a little, he's just going through that stage where everything is interesting and he's curious about things. And as a result, he's taking the odd risk that perhaps hasn't been the best idea. I know Brent had the sighting with the wild dogs where Hosanna went up the tree and then came down the tree far too soon, if I'm not mistaken. And the wild dogs were very, very close to catching him. Krula actually had to come down the tree to try and distract, and then he got grabbed by the baboons as well with James.
There was that incident, hey?
Where Shungile is
Karen.
Gone. She's gone.
Clever girl. I mean, leopard, they stay alive longer when they learn how to run away first and not to fight. But how long did he take to kill that little Nyala?
Must have been 40 seconds. It was a lot shorter than I expected.
Really?
The way that he grabbed it, he tried to jump up out of the drainage line and he broke its neck really fast. So just its neck snapped and it was over.
Isn't
Thank
it amazing
goodness.
At how strong a leopard's jaws are, even at such a young age, where they haven't really had much exercising to do, much the same as hyena and lion. Young cubs tend to chew as much on whatever they can find as possible, and it's just to develop those massive jaw muscles. We have got a leopard skull here to show you just how big those muscles are. If you take a profile from there, basically, and you imagine this being rounded. So that is basically a leopard's head, round like that. Everything that you see where my hands are is muscle attachment, making for an enormous amount of bite force. And that obviously needs to be exercised. And the fact that he managed to break that little Nyala's neck so quickly is just incredible for me. Hopefully it bodes for things to come. I know he's, what would you call it? Cousin, no? Brother.
Quarantine, yes, his brother.
His brother, excuse me.
It gets confusing.
It does get a bit confusing. I know Quarantine has the ability, or has learnt, that he can kill kudus quite easily.
Yeah.
And I know that he's got a reputation for killing full-grown kudu, and as recently we just heard down the pipeline that he killed a full-grown male kudu. Now, this is a 500-pound animal that a leopard weighing maybe 100 pounds at the moment, maybe a little bit less than that, has managed to subdue and kill quite easily. It just shows you the genes are strong in these ones.
I know. I don't know what Karula puts in her milk, but obviously it works very, very well. Now, Roger, you wanted to know, because you sort of got the idea that Shungile will become independent sooner than Hosanna, and you're wondering what sort of ages that we're looking at in terms of when they will become independent. So Shungile, it will probably be earliest at a year and a half, maybe probably closer to two. Hosanna will probably stick around, and what you'll find with males, they stay in their natal area for quite a lot longer than the females, and they go back and they visit mom and they have some of her kill. Sometimes they've even been recorded sharing kills with their mom and her new litter, because of course at some point around a year and a half, when they're a year and a half old, Karula will go back into estrus and start mating again. Now, all in all, I think we've really... I'm sorry you've missed out on this set of Karula's cubs. They are such wonderful little characters.
I must say, I'm not that sorry. I quite enjoy being out on foot. I would choose that over... Yeah. over. I see enough of it on the screens with you, in any case. And it's amazing how you always manage to find them. All right. On that note, we're going to send you over to a wet Byron, who's still sitting with that male line.
Now, look, this lion appears as if it wants to call. Listen, listen, everybody. I hope you can hear it. I'll move shortly. That's all communicating, trying to find where the other lions are. I'll just have a look here quickly. Oh no, wait, let's wait. I don't know if he's going to give a proper roar. Doesn't look like it. Maybe. Well, but we will follow him. Just wanted to show you something very beautiful quickly. I've got a stowaway. Beautiful praying mantis. Look at that. Isn't that wonderful? So we've got a tiny little insect and a big male lion. Also trying to get out of the rain. I'm gonna see if I can put you down over here next to me if you don't mind. You can have a little seat there. Oh no, he's attacking me. There we go. Alright. So I've got a passenger. Let's see if I can get to this lion quickly. Now the thing is, I can't see anything around me. Oh, this is going to be tricky now. Hang on, sorry. Hold on. As I thought, this is very difficult. Pete, you want to know if lions are good swimmers? Not necessarily, but they do swim if they have to. And the best example of that would be in Botswana. And we have lions in Botswana, especially in the flood season, that they do. All he's done is he's moved into a bit of an area that's a little bit more sheltered. And there he is. So half a little call, but nothing serious, and now he's settled down again. So Pete, there are lions that do swim a little bit in Botswana when they've got to cross channels and that in the delta, but not really often, and they'd prefer not to. But they do, and they're fairly decent swimmers. Not great, but they will if they have to. Can you? There's another little bug buzzing around in here somewhere in the car. We've got a lot of hitchhikers today, which is all right. See, now you can see he's not very comfortable. He's not enjoying the rain as much anymore. It looks a little bit cold. It's tough to say, really. He's kind of facing the rain. He's kind of facing the rain at the moment. But with a bit of wind, I mean, it's only when the wind blows that the rain will blow into his face, really. I mean, he's facing the wind a little bit. Trying to see what's making a noise. There's something in here. I don't know what it is. Sorry, let me just have a look around here. It doesn't sound very happy, whatever it is. I don't know, I can't find it. A little bug of sorts. It's just in there, and I can just hear it buzzing around our rain covers and everything that we've got in the vehicle. Well, I know how this lion feels. He's just trying to get warm. Look, he's oh no, he's hiding his face behind that stick. I'll have to move a little bit so we can see his face properly. Let me move slightly for us. And again, I hope there's no one or nothing behind us because I can't see. There we go. How's that? Is that a bit better? There we go. And again, now because we've got the rain cover on or the roof on, I've just got to position a bit better so that we can see it. Oh, there's still some little sticks in that, but at least we can see him clearly. Looked like he heard something there for a second. Now, everyone, this morning, I had tracks of the Nkuhuma Pride, and I was wondering which direction they went in. Now, from what I saw, from the tracks that I saw, it looked like they walked across along the Buffalo's cut line, and then they headed south onto Juma, and near a road called Hyena. So where we are sitting now, if I can show you from where we're sitting, it was in that direction and not too far, probably about a kilometer or two, so maybe a mile, just over a mile in that direction. That's where I had the tracks and where I thought they were moving through into the block, and I thought the lions were possibly still in there. So maybe this male still meets up with them tonight at some point if they do return a call. Or the call from the line, not an actual telephone call. Oh dear, see what the rain does to us. I managed to hit my finger on the door. That's quite painful. Sheesh. I think we deserve an extra helping of dinner this evening. Gert, what do you think?
Sure.
For pancakes. Pancakes out in the bush. Emma, you want to know if the behavior of the animals changes in this weather? Yes, definitely. As you can see, I mean, this lion's still lying down into cool weather, but he's trying to get a bit of shelter. He's under that little bush, trying to get out of the rain as much as he possibly can. But again, it's not easy. I mean, you're still going to get wet out here no matter what. We definitely see that some animals don't move around as much. A lot of the antelope species, especially these young impala, the impala with the youngsters at the moment, they will all be congregated very close together, because if they're together, they can rely on one another to keep an eye out for any potential predators. And if they do see any, it's a bit easier for them to move. and get out of harm's way. So a lot of the antelope species will move, not just antelopes, some of the other animals too, perhaps buffalo and that, maybe move into an area and get a little bit closer to one another. And because of this rain, it's harder, as we spoke about earlier, it's harder for them to pick up on where predators might be, and they can't hear them or smell them. So they'll move into an area that's probably even a bit open so that they can see a lot better, but that's mainly at night. At the moment, with it still being light, they will still be able to see quite well, but they'll try and probably head under the trees, but in closer, congregate closer, a lot closer, so that they can keep an eye out for any danger. So it does affect the movement and behavior of animals, definitely. And I just remembered now, and we spoke about it this morning, but I believe it is Thanksgiving today. So a very happy Thanksgiving to all our American viewers. I'm sure there's some turkeys that are going to be roasted a little bit later today. Still a wonderful, that wonderful sound of the rain hitting the roof. I'm sure you can all hear it back home. See, now's the time that we could have a nice hot chocolate or something, or nice warm drink out here. So I wonder, maybe if we ask Rebecca or Jerry, they could bring us a warm drink out in the rain. Maybe the chances of that happening are very, very slim. Let's head back to Steph in the tent and see what he has.
All right, let me just get all my things in order over here. And it's getting wetter and wetter there. But we have managed to put the rain cover onto Rusty, and so we've lost a member of my team over here, left an empty jacket and a warm seat to rush out to Rusty and get out there. And obviously with these new rain covers that we've got, it allows us to go back into the bush and to see everything as it is in the rain, which is something new and exciting for Safari Live. I know we've been doing it in the past, plus minus, but hopefully with these new roofs we've got, we can do it more often. Now, one thing that has been quite exciting lately is the fact that the woodland kingfishers have returned. So we've just prepped Brent's very exciting discovery of the woodland kingfisher, and then we're going to talk about who won the competition afterwards as being closest to guessing what it is. We'll see you on the other side of this.
Oh yes, here it is. Eggsy, are you ready? Are you ready, Eggsy? Now, where did it go? Don't fly again. Oh, there you go. Boom, there it is. Woodlands kingfisher. There we go. Definitely worth taking a few seconds on our way to the lines to have a look at the exquisite woodlands kingfisher. I'm hoping he jumps out into the light so you can see that electric blue color that is on him.
Isn't that exciting to see that they're back again? And you know, they travel all the way from Central Africa, come all the way down here, just for the bounty of insects. And obviously the fact that there's less rain down here, so they're not drowned out of the Central African rainforest that they come from. And exciting to see. Now, I don't quite know, talk about woodland kingfisher. There's one that just started to call right outside this tent right now as that clip finished. And but anyway, talking about that, I'm sure I'm gonna hear in a little bit who won the exactly, it's coming through. Kirsty chose the closest date on the 23rd. So that means that she was the closest. I don't know quite what prize she's going to win. We'll have to think of something, I don't know, a bucket of water on her head or something like that. Oh yeah, she wins her pride, as Rebecca has just told me in my ear. Now, those woodland kingfisher are quite, for me, one of the most striking birds out here. Now, Andrew has just asked me something about migrating birds. I'm sorry, Rebecca, you're just going to have to repeat that for me if you don't mind. Ah, has the drought impacted the return date of the migratory birds? Andrew, you asked me that question now. That's a good question.
Generally speaking, the birds that have left here and gone somewhere else wouldn't know that there's a drought here, and so they would arrive normally at the normal time. What I would think would happen is that at the end of a dry year, at the end of a dry spell, they might leave slightly earlier to go back up to wherever they go and spend their season. I don't think that it'll impact them much unless where they're going to is also having a bit of a drought. Now, it's not uncommon to have droughts over very large areas and expanses, especially for these woodland kingfishers that go all the way up to the Central African rainforests. If the food is not that available out there, or the rains come early, for instance, they will move down here. Varies a couple of weeks a year. I suppose the danger out here is to think that everything is sort of static and that everything is in some form of equilibrium. I like to believe that nothing is static out here and that nothing is in equilibrium or in balance, that everything is constantly shifting. There's so many dynamics that change the way animals behave, birds migrating, insect eruptions, the way different mammals behave with one another. We really don't understand all the different variables there at all. And, you know, it's quite exciting to see every single year that comes through over here that something different happens. Now, Lionheart, you've asked me to describe to you all, or run through all the different kingfishers that we've got here. Let me see if I can do it without my bird book in front of me. Let's start at the biggest. We've got the giant kingfisher, pied kingfisher, woodland kingfisher, grey hooded kingfisher, grey-headed or brown-headed, grey-headed kingfisher. We have got malachite, pygmy kingfishers. Let me see if I can remember anything more. You're going to see my eyes unfocus here as I'm busy trying to think if there's one that I've missed. Of course, there might be one or two that I've missed, and for those that I've missed, feel free to just sort of tweet them through to us quickly at the hashtag SafariLive, or use the email questions@wildearth.tv, and I'll share the ones that I've missed. So let's just start perhaps from the smallest one again. Pygmy kingfisher, malachite kingfisher, takes care of the two smallest kingfishers. Next up on the line would be the grey-hooded kingfisher. Oh, the brown-headed kingfisher as well. Striped kingfisher, I forgot. Pied kingfisher and the giant kingfisher. I'm going to say that. I've probably forgot one. I feel like I'm forgetting one. Anyway. Oh, and woodlands kingfisher, of course, as well. There's also that woodland kingfisher we just had a look at. And so, yes, I feel that that's pretty much it. So quite a few, in actual fact. Right. And on that embarrassing note, I'm sure you can see the colour of my forehead having changed this subtly gymnogene red. We're going to send you over to Byron and that kitty cat.
Sounds like it's quite fun in the tent there, trying to name all the kingfishers. Our lion has just settled down even further. He's not too happy, and its temperatures obviously dropped quite a bit, and it's getting a bit colder, especially because it's wet now and there's still a bit of a breeze, not as windy as it was earlier, but it does make things a bit colder when you are wet and there's this cool breeze blowing past. So we have a look at our little praying mantis again, my passenger who's sat very comfortably on the seat next to me, and I've just got him back again. I've got a new friend. Look at that. This little creature will be very well camouflaged in the bush, that grey coloration. Excuse my dirty hands, but it's from all the rain and the mud and the covers that we've had to put on. And I just want to turn him slightly. Look at that. Look at those big eyes. Oh, that is so cool. Very, very interesting. Isn't that amazing? Looks like he's got little stripes in between the eyes. See his big front legs tucked in. That little leg of his, and I don't know if he's got a cramp, but he's been stretching it a lot, so I'm not sure what he's doing with it. Oh, look at that. Those front legs of theirs. Cleaning his mandibles a bit. They are incredible little creatures, these little praying mantis or praying mantids. Oh, the lion has his head up now. Oh, there we go. Come on, roar for us, please. Oh, wonderful. Look at that, shaking the water. Listen. Not quite a proper roar, but a bit of a roar nonetheless. And again, I think he's just trying to communicate with the other lions, find out where they are, and if they've got some shelter or food. He's feeling a little bit lonely out here, I think. Much like I am. I haven't heard any other vehicles on the radio. Luckily, Gert's here with me, but everyone else seems to have disappeared. And but at least we've got this male lion for company. And that low call that he was giving there, or that bit of a roar, not quite a full roar, but like I said, just to communicate with other lions and see if they are around or find out where they are. A lovely sound. It's so nice to hear those lions roar. But you can see he's not happy about the rain at all. He's probably getting a bit chilly. So that's why he's decided to move even further under that bush, just for as much shelter as he can possibly find. Got another little stowaway. Oh no, where did that go? Oh dear, I lost him. There was another little stowaway, but I seem to have lost him in the footwell here somewhere. Might find its way up my leg again soon. Ah, so it sounds like Jamie's back out. She's very brave. Well, that's nice. She's back out on the vehicle. Let's head to her and get an update from her.
I hear that Byron has been looking for stowaways in his vehicle. And obviously, yes, we are back out. Rusty's roof is on and we are ready to go and ready to join Byron in his adventures. Oh, got something to show you. How's that, Andre? Isn't he gorgeous, this little rhino beetle? It was sitting at my footwell. I'm just going to uncover my monitor so that I can see what you're seeing. Whoa, 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 sorry. How cool is this little guy? No, don't fall. Whoa. There we go. Hi, buddy. That little rhino horn on the top of it. One of the small five. A rhino beetle. He's casually making his way along my hand. And of course we get all sorts of exciting things coming out of... No, we can't cut my sleeve. No. Oh, we're going. And we're gone. Hold on. Sorry, little guy. Girl, here we go. No, sorry, I know you want to be in there, but you can't be. I'm sure I would want to be in there as well. It must be really nice and warm. A truly fantastic, almost prehistoric looking creature. All part of the same family as the dung beetles, and the same family as the strongest beetle in the world. Their equivalent strength is absolutely massive. If they were human-sized, they would be beyond our comprehension in terms of strength. You can see the little antenna working furiously. And each and every single one of these beetle species will be covered in mites that help to keep them clean, help to keep the bits of them moving and working and the joints all working, because of course they've got all of these jointed leg and head parts and body parts. Where would you like to go, buddy? What would you like to do? You want to be let loose? They've all come out after the rain. And cleaning his feet a little bit, stretching out. Look. You can actually see the casing, the wing casing, starting to shift.
Can you hold him a bit further? I can get closer.
Bit further. Yeah. Bit further. There we go. What are you doing? Look at that. How cool is that? Stretching, cleaning. I'm hoping he's not preparing to deposit something on my hand, but it wouldn't be the worst thing in the world. I love watching the way that these beetles move, and I find that it's the same with all of them when they walk. Look at that. How double-jointed his legs are, moving in every direction. But if you watch them walking, you can see just how well the six legs work together in tandem in order to propel the beetle forward. So what will happen is it will put, I've watched this many, many times in slow motion. Wow, I did not know their legs could bend that way. Wiping himself off. If you watch him as he walks, as he starts walking forward, and I'm going to put him on the dashboard cover in a moment. Watch the way that he walks. So the 2 feet on the outside, the front one and the back one, will move forward whilst he pivots using the opposite side, and then he'll swap around. So he essentially walks one side at a time, but the front foot and the back foot move together, and then the middle foot. So the front foot and the back foot of one side will move at the same time as the middle foot on the other side. I hope you got all that. It sounds very complicated. It's not. I'll show you exactly what I mean in a slow motion video. I think I still have it. Melinda, while we look at our rhino beetle, you want to know what are the rest of the small five. Okay, so we have the rhino beetle, we have the elephant shrew, which is a little rodent type creature that we hardly ever get to see actually. But of course the shrews with their extended upper lip to form almost what looks like a tiny elephant trunk. Here we go. So the elephant shrew, the antlion, they form little pits underneath the surface of the soil, very powerful jaws that they then catch any ants or anything that falls in there. And we've got the leopard tortoise we see on a regular basis. What have I forgot? Oh, and the buffalo weaver. The buffalo weaver is a type of bird. So one more time, it's the rhino beetle, the antlion, the elephant shrew, the leopard tortoise, and the buffalo weaver are the small five. And we've already got one. Perhaps we can try and see if we can't see another. I'm certain we're going to find a tortoise or two that's come out to play with these reins. What do you think, Mr. Beetle? Or Mrs., sorry, shouldn't be. I don't actually know how to tell the difference between male and female with them. Let me just see if I can show you how he walks. I'll spread this cover out. Now they're phenomenally strong. You can actually feel him pushing against me. There we go. Do you mind if I just... No, I know you want to stay on my fingers. Let's go over to Byron.
All right. I'm hoping he calls properly. Listen, everybody, listen. He has started calling again. Oh, not quite. It started out like it was going to be a big roar. He's definitely looking for the pride. That's why he's calling. Because he's facing the direction that I thought they were in earlier this morning. And hopefully he has better luck in finding them than I did. I was hoping it looked like he was going to roar. And maybe we're lucky and we do get a full roar from this male soon. That would be wonderful. I wouldn't be surprised if he does do it. I do think he may get up and start moving fairly soon. And I mean, the temperature's cooling down. The rain is not as bad as it was earlier. So perhaps he does decide to get up, start moving, and maybe a big roar to find the rest of the pride, find out where they are. Hopefully they return the call. Still drizzling slightly though, you can hear it on the roof. Would be nice if he did get up and move around for us. Sorry, let's head back to Jamie, and she's got the rhino beetle she'd like to show you.
I'm sorry, but I'm absolutely mesmerized by the movements and the entire design of this little beetle. It's almost like a living robot, the way that it moves and the double-jointed nature of its legs, and everything about it is so perfectly designed. I think it's actually doing a little bit of drying off now. Remember how it was rolling its abdomen a little bit earlier? And while we've been sitting here watching it, just after, while Mfumo was doing a half-hearted roar, the wings started to poke out from the back, or started to poke out underneath the casing. And I think it might have been drying its wings. That was Jandre's suggestion, and I think he might be spot on. Drying off its wings after perhaps getting soaked on the drive back from Cheetah Plains. I know the feeling, little beetle. I know exactly how you feel. Everything about it is fascinating. Now, James, as far as I know, our rhino beetle's horn... Thank you for sending through your question, James. Sorry, I'm mesmerized. I can't stop watching it. I don't think I've ever seen up close, or as up close, as Jandre's camera is able to get us. James, you want to know if its horn is for defense or for some other reason. As far as I know, it's used by the males in conflict with each other to fight over access to females, to fight over access to resources. But then I think females have it as well, so I'm actually not 100% sure if there's a secondary reason for it. You know, kind of in the way that, might be in the way that giraffe females have horns, well, ossicones, to be more specific. But I'll double check for you, James, and I'll get back to you on that. I'm going to ask Steph. And Steph, of course, is the king of the small things, and he knows almost everything there is to know about the little creatures out here. As far as I know, and I have seen them fighting each other before, it's used as a pushing method up against each other. So they're kind of like little miniature tanks, or robot wars, for any of you that have ever watched Robot Wars at one point in your life. They sort of go towards each other and try and use that horn as a battering ram and to flip each other over. I just love the grips on his feet as well. Those little protrusions that I can feel digging into my skin. Not sore. It just shows how stable he is in terms of gripping something. Look at that. He's amazing. A miracle of design. I want to try, I'm just going to turn him slightly. I'm going to try and get his head facing us. And let me just do that so that we can actually have a view of his face. And his mouth parts, hopefully. We can try and see if we can see him. Look, he's shaped like a shovel almost, but with the horn protruding from the top. Now, Michael, you want to know where the rhino beetle's eyes are. And that's honestly what I've been... Shabby's wiping his face. I know that feeling. It's exactly how I was feeling earlier. Now, Michael, I don't know exactly where they are on this particular type of beetle. I'm trying to see. My feeling is that they're in front of the horn on the flattened side of the top of the head. No, don't do that. Let's turn you a little bit. Can you see eyes there? I can't tell if those are drops or if they're eyes sitting.
Two protrusions on the middle of the thorax there. And I don't know if that's what those bumps are.
The two protrusions. Yes, I see exactly what you mean.
They look like eyes, but I don't know if they're just pseudo
eyes. I think they're just pseudo eyes. I think the eyes are underneath the horn in the front of the face there. Look how he's got two sets of antenna as well. Or at least he's got mouth parts. I don't know if there's a mouth parts or antenna protruding. Look there. Can see them. Moving out. I don't know exactly where its eyes are. I want to try and get a little bit closer to investigate. Just to try and see. Oh, that helps, Chandra. Thank you. I'm sorry. Got to turn him again. He's determined not to let us look at his face. I think those are his eyes there at the base of the horn. Looks like he might have compound eyes, but they look like they might be simple. You can see, scrabbling for purchase, his foot can't grip on my fingernail. Keeps sliding off. Hyena. Can hear a hyena calling. Sounds like from Galago Shortcut. Looks like he's got two little hands in front of his face that he's waving around. He's having a little party. I think he's trying to orientate himself or herself. I keep calling it a him. I don't know that it's a him. He is mesmerizing. It is mesmerizing. Okay. I think I'm going to deposit our lovely rhino beetle off to the side. I don't think he or she really wants to be in the vehicle with me. Can't tell if those are eyes or not. I think they might be. No idea. I'm going to have to go and do a closer examination of rhino beetle anatomy. Sorry, I was going cross-eyed trying to focus on this beetle. I'm going to jump out and pop him down outside, and then I'm going to go and look for the hyena that's calling. Okay, let's release you into the wild, little guy or girl. I'm wearing Brent's rain jacket, which is very, very convenient. Okay, pop you down here. There you go. Bye-bye. Oh, he doesn't want to leave. There we go. Good luck. Let's go and see if we can't find that hyena. And I'm going to go and find out a lot more about where the eyes and the anatomy of those beetles. Something in the road there that may or may not be birds. Ah, how wonderful. Of course, what a good way to try and figure out the answers to my confusion. Let's go and have a look at one underneath the microscope.
Yes, it gives me purpose over here to try and help back up Jamie. And we've taken a dung beetle out of our collection of beetles, or out of James's collection of beetles, and I've managed to find the eye for you. Just have a look over here. So that white that you're looking at right there, that is the eye of the dung beetle. It is, of course, opaque in this particular dung beetle because it is unfortunately deceased. But what I will do is, as soon as you come back to me, is show you where it's situated and located on our dung beetles there, so that I can actually show you exactly where it is. But that white opaque ball is the one eye of this particular dung beetle. All right, let me show you where it is. Here's the dung beetle from the collection, very similar to Jamie's dung beetle. You can have a look over there. Also got the same spade in the front and the horns on the top. And this one just got a little protrusion here as well. Let me show you exactly where they are. Let me put it down over here for you. The eyes of the dung beetle are located there, inside there. Let me see if I can turn it towards you there. One there and one there. That is where the eyes of the dung beetle is. Located just behind the head, and that's what it is. All right, now we have got another clip to show you. this time of some male lions fighting with one another. Now, it's not uncommon for male lions to fight with one another in coalitions. They generally are with each other when they are cubs, all the way from when they are cubs, and the hierarchy in lion prides is already established by the time these lions take over a pride. And so when you have a coalition, there's already a male lion that likes to fight and one that likes to hunt and one that is a bit of a ladies' man. They've sorted that out from when they are youngsters and those boisterous cubs that we see so often. That play out is done. But in this particular case, a male had mating rights over a female. His brother or cousin came in, part of his coalition came in, and what he did to do, well, what he did was try and usurp the position. And it was defended quite aggressively. Now, what I want you to see is the fact that the male lions don't really bite one another. There's a lot of posturing, a lot of noise, even gets a claw stuck in a hand. But you'll see that a real lion fight is one where teeth are sunken in. There's intent to actually kill the opponent. In this particular instance, it was just defending his female from the usurper, his brother, but without real killing intent. Although when it comes to lions, they are rather magnificent when they fight with one another. In this particular instance, have a look at this.
Oh, there's another male's just arrived. Oh no, it's going to be brotherly love till one of them gets too close to the ladies. There we go. I can't see which Birmingham. There we go. Just as I predicted, soon as the one tried to get too close to the ladies, brotherly love turned into a brotherly smack. Look at this, he's chasing him. They're fighting, the lionesses joined in beating up the male. Okay, we've got to get in there, guys. We've got to get in there. Hold on. Predicted. Soon as the one tried to get too close to the ladies, brotherly love turned into a brotherly smack. Can you hear the cubs in the... Let me just get forward again a little bit. Wow, I'm shaking. That was incredible.
Wasn't that the most amazing thing you've ever seen in terms of lion interaction? And I must be honest with you, I think Brent hit the nail right on the head with his description there. Brotherly fight with one another. You've all seen growing up with siblings and growing up with kids who box one another over toys and whatnot. Isn't that just at a lion scale? Something absolutely magnificent. On that note, why don't we go and have a look at one of those lions that were involved in that fight with Byron.
So it looks like the rain has settled a little bit, which is great. And you know what, we've been very fortunate to spend so much time with this lion, and I do think he may get up and start moving a little bit. I wonder if we don't continue on our drive, and let's use the spotlight. It is dark enough now. Maybe we lucky and we get some nocturnal movement for the last 20 minutes or so, or 25 minutes of drive. And I think maybe with the rain, who knows, hang on. Oh, come on. One big roar for us. I'm asking very nicely. There we go. Oh. Come on. Well, that was two big roars. Incredible sound. I absolutely love it. It is definitely definitely my favorite sound in the bush, I think, is that beautiful lion roar, especially when you get this close to them. And if you are lucky enough to experience it in real life, it is incredible. It's an amazing sound. And now that will all be communication with the other lions to find out where they are, as I said, trying to work out what they are up to. And I wouldn't be surprised if we find these lions this evening moving around, or even tomorrow, if they've managed to kill something, especially because of this weather that we had, overcast, rainy weather, and there is a good possibility. But I think let's stick to our plan. Let me get the spotlight quickly. And with all this rain, and it's just cleared up now, which is very, very nice. Let's move on and see what we can find moving around at night. We're so lucky to have sat with this lion for so long. He kept us company through the rain. So thank you very much, Mfumo. Eleanor, thank you for your comment. You said you enjoyed sitting with the lion and always wondered what lions do in the rain when it does rain. So as you could see, not much. Try and look for a bit of shelter and settle in. So it was really great to sit and spend time with him. And that's what it's all about at times, you know, just patience and sitting around, enjoying the sightings and not racing around, just trying to see how much you can see, because I find you do miss a lot of animals' natural behavior if you are racing from one sighting to another. So especially when I'm guiding guests, I like to take my time and sit and really enjoy a sighting with the guests. And you have a plan, you've got a 3 or 4 day plan. Obviously with us it's a bit different. But generally on a safari you've got a plan, so you'll plan to go and look for lions one day, and plans do change out here constantly. You never know what you're going to see or bump into, but it helps to have a bit of a plan and that you don't rush around just wondering what you're going to see next. Appreciate what you're seeing in the moment and don't think about what you're going to see next, because I think sometimes we take for granted these wonderful sightings when we are sitting with these animals, like a male lion like that, and enjoying him roaring and moving around, shaking the rain off of him. It's important to enjoy those special sightings, because who knows when it's going to happen again. Just trying to have a look and see if we can't find any little scorpions or a chameleon. Some eyes in here. Hang on, was it a little bush baby? Let me see. Oh, it's just disappeared. I just caught a reflection of some eyes, possibly a bush baby. Hang on a second, let's have a look. It was very, very brief and it seems to have disappeared. I think it was possibly a bush baby, but one that was just hiding in this thicket. We might see some others around here, perhaps. All right, well, I'm going to continue on our night drive. Let's head back to Jamie and get an update from her.
Oh. I'm also looking for the reflection of eyes, but in my case, I'm hoping for something this evening slightly larger than a bush baby. Not that I don't really love bush babies, but I imagine, given that they're difficult to film at the best of times, I can imagine poor Gendre trying to struggle to film a bush baby with the roof involved as an additional complicating factor. Gendre, do you think it would be fun?
Yeah,
it would be fun. Now, I am in search, though, of hyena. I have not seen a spotted hyena in far too long, and I feel as though I'm going into some kind of spotted hyena withdrawal. It really feels like forever since I last saw them, and I heard one calling while we were looking at that beetle, and now I want to try and figure out where they are. So what I'm doing now, tried following the call. Hyenas are so difficult to find. Often they're standing in the middle of a block, whooping away. just making themselves almost impossible to find. But I'm going through to Sydney's Dam, which is where they often cross. This whole patch of boundary from Sydney's Dam, which is in the top northwestern corner of Juma, it's actually on Biffles Hook, and all the way to the east towards a road called Gallagher Shortcut that their den used to be on. And this whole section, whenever I come through first thing in the morning, is just a maze of hyena tracks. And that's why we're here at the moment. I'm sort of hoping against hope. We might bump into one. We might see one. And of course, this is the antelope. This is the area where Viam and myself saw the African wildcat, which should also be an incredibly exciting find. I saw some eyes there, but it turned out it was a dacre. Dacre, for some reason, tricked me, or have tricked me quite a few times. I think it's the fact that they go and they sleep in quite thick vegetation, and you just get the glimpse of the shine of the eyes, and they're just the right height that they could be a leopard crouching down, or they could be a serval or a caracal, you know, wishful thinking and all. They could be a caracal at that sort of height, and they seem to be the most tricky. Dacre and bushbuck are the antelope that tend to catch us out the most in terms of thinking something's there when it isn't. And of course, the search for a chameleon continues. There's lots of exciting things to look for. Come on, Sydney's Dam. Do your magic. I know that they are not far away from us at all. Their den is not far away from us at all. It just feels like they've abandoned us. It is quite a beautiful evening now that the rain has let up. And aside from John Bray and myself feeling slightly damp, it has really been a lovely afternoon. I'm still riding the high from the Styx cubs. They were absolutely awesome. Something's there. Hold on. No, impala. As soon as you see multiple eyes reflecting back at you, you're almost guaranteed to be looking at something like almost inevitably something like a herd of impala. Now, for our newer viewers, I'm listing off all of these antelope, but I'm not stopping to show you them. And the reason that I'm not doing that is we do not shine our spotlights on diurnal animals. In other words, animals that move about during the day. Sorry, something's more impala there. And the reason that we don't do that is it can actually, I mean, they do have a slightly better night vision than humans do. They do also have a reflective layer in the back of their eyes known as a tapetum lucidum. But it's not as effective as it is in nocturnal animals like the scrub hare that I'm trying to show you, but that is playing hard to get. No. Oh, sorry. So we don't spotlight the diurnal animals because ultimately if you shine, it's okay to briefly sort of pass over them with a spotlight. But if we were to sit for a couple of minutes at a time, what we actually do is we take away their ability to see in the dark temporarily. But just that is enough to make them vulnerable to a predator attack. And that is, yes, completely unacceptable. Ha ha. Hello. Long time no see. Ha. Finally, a right call when it comes to our hyenas. Hello, you two. And where have you been all our lives? Well, not all our lives, but the last few months. On your way straight into Juma, hey? Why don't you stay there? Here goes the sloping back of the spotted hyena. There's a second one all the way at the back there. We're going to try and stay with them for as long as we possibly can. Just hold on one moment. I'm going to reposition to see. Ah, they're so fast that they are very, very tricky to stay with. And we won't be able to follow them through this dense vegetation. But let's put ourselves in a position that this one's going to walk right past us. Yay! I'm so chuffed. Hello, you. Oh, sorry about the squeaks, everybody. Hyena's not too bothered. Right, which path are you going to walk? See if we can get a nice IDing shot. I know you're blocked, Jandre, but he's going to pop out in a second or two. Hello. I don't even know which hyena I'm looking at anymore. It's been that long since I've seen them. Oh, one very full hyena. They've obviously been snacking on something at Buffle's Hook. Oh, I've missed you guys. That is a spotted hyena, an animal that we used to spend hours and hours with back in the day when we still had them denning, in other words, looking after their babies on Juma. You can't see behind me. And then one day, just like that, they upped and left us and they moved to the north of our traverse area, so the north of where we can drive. Now many of you will think of hyenas perhaps for our new viewers. Which way are they going to go? Let me see if I can meet them on Sandy Patch. I'm hoping, no, they're going to Access Road. All right, let's try. We're gonna try. Some of you that perhaps have only joined us recently and you've missed out on the time that we've spent with the spotted hyena, you might see them as something that is to be reviled, as terrible, cowardly scavengers. And that, of course, could not be further from the truth. They're very capable hunters, although they haven't needed to hunt all that much at the moment. They're very capable hunters, they're very intelligent creatures, and they have an incredibly complex social structure and hierarchy that is fascinating to observe and to follow. And what we were in the process of doing was really tying together an idea of who was who in the hyena clan, what kind of role they played, whether it was them. I think we'd figured out who the matriarch was, we'd figured out some of the high-ranking females, the low-ranking females. So all in all, we were really coming to get to know our hyena clan particularly well. Sorry, I've just got to dim all of my lights so that we can go past these impala, especially since they are all pregnant, except the males, of course. Hello, ladies. Good question, Michael. You wanted to know, because of course each of our hyenas had names that is a sort of a combined effort of the various naming of the various hyenas. Michael, you wanted to know how old Gwen's cubs would be. Gwen's cubs were probably only about 10 days old on the 17th of June, which is around when we did our Father's Day TV show special. Which means they were born around the 7th of June, which means they are July, August, September, October, November, 5 months old. They'd be spotty, they'd have all of their spots. Now, baby spotted hyenas, when they come out of the den site, they're all wobbly, their back legs aren't as strong, they are playful, they're curious, they don't have spots like the adults, they are a dark, rich brown. And they are probably one of the cutest baby, and I'm biased, because they're one of my favorite predators. I mean, one of my favorite animals, definitely my favorite predator. But those little cubs are adorable. They're like little bears. I'm hoping we're gonna catch them on their way down Vuyatela Access. Oh, sorry. While I search for our hyenas once again, let's head across to Steph so that he can say goodbye from the tent.
Wasn't that pretty epic seeing those hyena back again on Juma after all this time of being away during our safari times? I have no doubt that they foray onto Juma quite often, probably every single night in actual fact, but we just don't see them during the safari times. There's a very good reason for that, and that female, I don't know if you noticed, the second one that Jamie was looking at looked to me like she was lactating. She was carrying quite far back, and those mammary glands of hers were quite swollen and engorged with what looked to me like milk. I'm almost 100% sure that there's some new baby hyena running around that particular clan. And that is probably why we haven't been seeing those hyena here. They tend to den where lions are not active at the moment. And for the last probably close on 80-odd days, we have had lions almost permanently around Juma and around the Juma camp and waterhole for the last long time. And that is, in my opinion at least anyway, why we haven't been seeing the hyena. They're denning, they've got some young cubs, and they've been keeping their distance from these lions. No doubt though, that as the grass starts to get longer and starts to come up in all these areas that have been a bit denuded of grass lately where there hasn't been any water, and the herds start to disperse, and with it will go the lion's source of easy food or easily to come by food over here, and they're going to start dispersing across their home range again, and it's going to make it more difficult for us at least to see the lions. But I think what's going to happen is we're going to see an increase, a sharp increase in the sightings of hyena again, which is quite exciting. Nice consolation prize at least anyway. All right, let's come to that part of the evening. I suppose I have to say goodbye and thank you very, very much for joining myself and VM on the bushwalk that turned out into the tent, which turned out into quite some interesting discussions and some seeing of those awesome clips. Wherever you are in the world, I just want to say have a good evening and a good day for the rest of it. We'll catch up with you tomorrow.
So no luck just yet, everyone. I'm so glad Jamie got to see that hyena. So funny, she just said she wanted to see hyena. We could hear them. When we were sitting with the lion earlier, we could hear hyena calling. But I'm so glad she got to see one. We haven't seen hyena for a long time. That's really, really great. I'm searching for chameleons and little scorpions, but no luck just yet. But who knows, we might find something soon. We've got a few more minutes. And there's a wonderful smell in the air now after the rain. Just kind of freshens everything up and all the dust settles. Beautiful, cool evening. Some impala close to us. All coming out into the clearings for the evening. And they want to try. Well, the reason they do that is basically, you know, we spoke about it all afternoon, is for safety, especially now with the weather that we're having. They prefer staying out in the clearings in general, just to stay alert and aware of what's going on around them, so they can keep a lookout for any potential predators. And out in the open, they could easily run away and evade predators. Sure, it's becoming surprisingly difficult to spot any chameleons. Now, I know James and I had one each about 3 weeks ago when we had those first big rains that came through. Maybe from tomorrow or the next day, after a bit more rain and heat, we might start getting some little chameleons around. Would be nice. Now, something else I'd like to see and that I haven't seen for a while are the giant eagle owls. Now, when I was here in June, we managed to hear them quite often, and I saw about three or four that I managed to find while we were out on drive. But for some reason at the moment, I haven't heard a single one. So hopefully we'll have some, who knows, maybe soon again we'll be able to find some. Anyway, I'm going to say goodbye and good night to all of you. I hope you've all had a wonderful drive. Thank you for keeping us company. Hope you enjoyed it, even though it was raining. Thank you very much to Gert on camera with me this afternoon. And we're going to head back to Jamie. We'll see you all tomorrow. Bye, everyone.
I think we've had an amazing afternoon. First, what was that? I don't know. Weird sound coming from the back of the vehicle. I'm just going to keep driving and pretend I didn't hear it. Definitely wasn't the vehicle's mechanics, so we're okay there. But I think it has been a magical afternoon. First the Styx cubs, then the hyenas. Yes, we did have an adventure. We had rain stinging our faces. I was struggling so much to see that there was a surprise elephant right next to me in the road while I was trying to get back. We had an adventure. And And just to top it off, the cherry on the cake, of course, is our hyena sighting, albeit very brief. And I don't even know which individuals they were. I'm going to have to find out from all of you later tonight. But it's still a pleasure to see them. Unfortunately, it seems as though I have lost them. I can't find them. I'm hoping they're going to start moving in this direction towards the camp and towards the dam. Maybe you might even have a chance to see them elsewhere. Maybe they'll be around tomorrow. Who knows? But it was exciting to see them once again. And those Styx cubs. Oh, my goodness. Love at first sight, those little bundles of fluff. And of course, with much better prospects than the previous cubs. We'll all be hoping for a more positive future for those little ones. All in all, a lovely day. I'm slightly damp and I would very much like to go home and dry off and put some warm, dry clothes on. Brent did bring me some, but I'm damp again from sitting down. So I'm going to have to head back home soon. Oh, and we have a roast chicken for our version of Thanksgiving. So it's going to be, all in all, a lovely night. So on that note, it's time for us to say goodbye. Thank you to Jean-Dre for his wonderful camera work, as always, and for getting soused with me, as well as to Rebecca and to Jerry in final control, and importantly, to all of you watching across the world. And actually, a big thank you to Alex for sorting out tech and their whole camera department for all jumping together and getting this show working this afternoon, despite the downpour. But as I said, most importantly, a big thank you to all of you. I hope you've had as much fun as I have. And we hope to see you again on the Sunrise Safari. Bye-bye, everybody, and happy Thanksgiving.